Assalamu alaikum and very good morning. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Afala yanzuruna ilal ibli kayfa khuliqat وإلى السماء كيف رفعت وإلى الجبال كيف نصبت وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت فذكر إنما مذكر صدق الله العظيم. ترجمه হচ্ছে সূরা গাশিয়া আয়াত নম্বর 17 থেকে 21. পরম করুণাময় দয়ালু আল্লাহর নামে শুরু করছি. তবে কি তারা উষ্ট্রের দিকে লক্ষ্য করে না যে কিভাবে তাকে সৃষ্টি করা হয়েছে এবং আকাশের দিকে যে কিভাবে ওটাকে সমুচ্চ করা হয়েছে এবং পর্বত মালার দিকে যে কিভাবে ওটাকে বসানো হয়েছে এবং ভূতলের দিকে যে কিভাবে ওটাকে সমতল করা হয়েছে? অতএব তুমি উপদেশ দিতে থাকো, তুমি তো একজন উপদেশদাতা মাত্র. ইন দ্য নেম অফ আল্লাহ, দি মোস্ট গ্রেসিয়াস অ্যান্ড মোস্ট মার্সিফুল. ডু দে নট লুক অ্যাট দ্য ক্যামেলস, হাউ দে আর ক্রিয়েটেড, অ্যান্ড অ্যাট দ্য হ্যাভেন, হাউ ইট ইজ রেইজড, অ্যান্ড অ্যাট দ্য মাউন্টেন্স, হাউ দে আর রুটেড, and at the earth how it is outspread. So remind them, you are only one who reminds. Thanking you.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Mr. Abul Qasim Khan, president of the Dhaka Chamber of Commerce and Industry, to kindly deliver his welcome address. Mr. President.
Bismillah Rahman Rahim. Today's chief guest, Dr. Taufiq Ilahi Chaudhary Bir Vikram, Honorable Advisor to the Prime Minister on Power, Energy and Mineral Resources Affairs, Government of Bangladesh. Special guest, Mr. Tajul Islam MP, Chairperson, Parliamentary Standing Committee on Ministry of Power, Energy, Mineral Resources, Government of Bangladesh. Honorable Ambassadors, High Commissioners, Past Presidents of DCCI, Dr. Fazlul Kabir, former Secretary and Moderator for today's program, Dr. Muhammad Tamim, Professor, Department of Petroleum and Mineral Resource Engineering, BUET, and our keynote speaker, respected expert panelists for today's discussion, high officials from various government agencies, the Chittagong Port Chairman, business leaders, Board of Directors of DCCI participants, representatives of both print and electronic media. Ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum, a very good morning to you all. On behalf of Dhaka Chamber of Commerce and Industry, I would like to welcome you to the DCCI Seminar on Energy Security 2030 Challenges and Opportunities. DCCI is always at the forefront in identifying the challenges facing the economy, business and industry, and therefore today's topic is one of the most important one given Bangladesh's present and future need for energy and power. DCCI is honored to have Dr. Taufiq Ilahi Chaudhary Bir Vikram, Honorable Advisor to the Prime Minister, as our chief guest, and Mr. MD Tajul Islam MP as our special guest today. Ladies and gentlemen, Bangladesh is truly in a position to accelerate its GDP growth today. We are the 35th largest economy, the 8th largest nation in terms of population, and one of the top three fastest growth centers of the world, growing at 7% plus. We from DCCI believe that in 17 years from now, by the year 2030, Bangladesh will become the 30th largest economy with $1 trillion GDP and having nearly $200 billion export earnings and per capita income reaching close to $6,000. Ladies and gentlemen, reliable and affordable energy and power is one of the preconditions to nation's growth and development, particularly for Bangladesh, given its economic need and requirements. It is vital to understand where this energy and power will be coming to fuel the need of 160 million people of Bangladesh to move forward to a middle-income country by 2021 and a developed one by 2041, as per the vision of our Honorable Prime Minister. Today, under the bold strategies, the government has in many ways improved the power situation. We must appreciate and thank the policies undertaken to tackle the long power crisis affecting our country. The current round of industrial momentum in Bangladesh has seen notable development in the power generation sector, increasing electricity generation up to 15,000 megawatt. We have seen the changes with such additions to the economy. However, we still have many new challenges facing us today, and given the growth trajectory and the accelerated growth that we want to achieve in the near future, we need a clear roadmap to our energy need and energy source. The demand for energy consumption is driven by growth of industrialization, modernization of agriculture sector, transformation of the rural economy, rapid urbanization, and improved standard of living. The demand for energy for industry-driven growth is on the rise to facilitate the economic graduation to a middle-income Bangladesh by 2021 and a developed Bangladesh by 2041. The supply side energy sector is not been able to support the growing demands today. Many factories and industries are severely affected by this shortage. The energy crisis driven by supply demand gaps create serious opportunity loss affecting the country's competitiveness. Ladies and gentlemen, the industrial revolution is yet to start in Bangladesh. And we from DCCI feel that industrial revolution is coming to Bangladesh, given that we have the right mix of all the preconditions to kickstart the revolution, and the number one precondition is energy and power. We will reach the desired accelerated growth as per the 7th five-year plan of 8% GDP growth based on sustainable and inclusive industrial and export-led growth. However, such accelerated growth, or any growth for that matter, needs to have the desired level of energy comfort or energy security. Today, the depletion of natural gas is creating a challenging situation. We are all aware that the current gas reserves are depleting fast, and it is estimated that current reserves will only last for about 6 to 8 years. And by the year 2024, our natural gas reserves will no longer be able to support our energy needs. I hope that our participants and panelists will discuss this critical resource that has fueled the growth of Bangladesh since its independence. Gas supply and exploration, both onshore and offshore, are critical for our future. This is one of the most important areas that need to be discussed today. We must increase efforts to maximize the exploration of new gas fields, particularly given that we have a defined maritime boundary that needs to be explored to discover new energy resources. On the other hand, we have been unable to bring our coal reserves as a major energy source to our energy mix. The ongoing debate on coal extraction methods and ways increases dependency on imported coal. We need to decide the fate of 160 million Bangladeshis and their well-being and their economic prosperity first. And therefore, we feel that Bangladesh needs to utilize optimum level of her coal reserves for its energy source, having enough reserves, which has enough reserves to fuel Bangladesh's energy and power needs for decades to come. Ladies and gentlemen, today coal is a major source for energy in numerous countries. It is worth mentioning that India, China, Indonesia, and Vietnam have undertaken 82% of the world's new coal-fired plants, as per the report from Energy and Climate Intelligence Unit, ECIU of UK. Just to share, out of which 384 in China, 149 in India, 24 in Vietnam, and 32 in Indonesia are under construction right now. Just to share one more fact of these plants, on these plants are being financed by China, Japan, and Korea, amounting to $16.7 billion, as per the report by Market Force, an Australian organization. Therefore, we must rethink seriously, as the world's largest, economies are both developed and developing economies still rely on the coal as a major resource in their energy mix. Energy solution through cross-border power trade with neighboring countries of Bhutan and Nepal is one of the other alternatives which needs to be explored. Ladies and gentlemen, we need to discuss on the following questions, which are, number one, how do we accommodate the large coal reserves of Bangladesh? Number two, what is the energy cost given when imported LNG will come on board? Three, gas reserves are depleting fast. New exploration needs to be fast-tracked. Four, what is the cost of energy and power estimates given the current roadmap of the government? Five, what will be the right energy mix ensuring Bangladesh's energy security? Ladies and gentlemen, Bangladesh is in a position of transition and transformation. However, it will be critical to see how we address this transition and transformation, since it will be very important to make the right investment in the right energy at the right time to take full advantage of achieving the desired level of prosperity and progress. Low-cost production base will not be adequate to qualify Bangladesh as a competitive and attractive investment destination. Efficient transportation, modern infrastructure with competitive and reliable energy will become the most crucial element for Bangladesh to remain competitive in global investors' map. And therefore, DCCI strongly feels that we must be energy competitive, and this competitiveness must be built on maximizing local energy resources. Ladies and gentlemen, today's discussion will bring new ideas from the keynote presentation by Dr. Mohammad Tamim. We have also five expert panelists to add their values and ideas. We also have our secretary to moderate the discussions. We also have investors, regulators, policy planners, economists, bankers, and media to discuss and debate in the open session. In concluding, I would again welcome you all to this important seminar organized by DCCI and look forward to your valuable participation. Thank you and Allah Hafiz.
Thank you, Mr. President. And now, ladies and gentlemen,
on anything else, but just start the presentation right away. Okay, it's quite understood and known that without diverse manufacturing sector, you cannot have high GDP growth and job creation. This is from 7th five-year plan, a quote. And if you look at the industrial growth of the last, not really last 5 years, but 2010 to 2015, you can see that the industrial growth has been about 10% on average, whereas the supply of electricity and water and gas, in 2011 it was 13%, but then it started going down, and in 2015 the growth was 7%. And if you look at the vision of the government, this is the vision. Our immediate vision is to grow over 7% GDP growth, 7.4% to be precise, for the next 10 years. And for 7 years growth to take place, we require at least 10% growth in energy supply, at least, even if not more. Last 5 years, the demand has grown and electricity supply has grown about 11%. which has been a good support, but probably not adequate. Now, Bangladesh is a single product, major product export country. You can see the split of different manufacturing sector, and 85% of the manufacturing export manufacturing sector is dominated by textile and garments. There are opportunities to diverse, and a roadmap has been shown in a JICA study, where it has been shown that in the early 70s we had jute as the major export product, and then from 80s till now it is the RMG, and in future, you know, they have given some diverse manufacturing, high-end, high value addition products that we will have to embark on to create more job and take the GDP growth beyond 7% or 8%. Now, in the 7th 5-year plan, 3 major barriers have been identified for the barrier for industrial growth. What are the barriers currently for the industrial growth? And that's power, transport, and land. One component that has been left out of these major barriers, in my opinion, is human resources. That has not been addressed in that plan. I think that needs to be addressed very strongly. So I have added it in a shaded, you know, 4th factor that is required, or that is a barrier right now for growth. Industry worries, the president already talked about their worries. Unreliable grid power right now, short and uncertain gas supply, and gap between promise and performance. So these are the worries of the industries right now. And of course, price unpredictability, that what is going to be the price of energy in future. Because unless you know the price, you cannot plan. And any project that has an uncertain major input as an ingredient, that creates a lot of insecurity and uncertainty. And right now, industry is suffering from that. So that needs to be addressed. And to address that, we have to look into the mandates of SDG, which actually the first rate is 2030 agenda. That actually talks about ensure access to affordable, reliable, sustainable, and modern energy for all. That is the number 7 point of the SDG goal. And that includes energy efficiency improvement, then supporting and more renewable energy is part of, and that is to have a sustainable growth. The emphasis has been given on energy efficiency and renewable energy as well. But the important factor is affordability, reliability, sustainability, and energy for all, modern energy. That is the focus of SDG. The government plan is no different. GOB plan and SDG goal are same or very similar. And combining these two, the power system master plan that has been done by JICA, they considered the SDG goal and the government vision that I showed earlier. They came up with 5 objectives and 5 key areas where you need to address address immediately and plan for future. And these are the 5 areas, and which has merged the 2 vision, SDG goals and government vision. I will go with each of these one after another. And the fuel mix optimization, which is very critical and important in the PSMP study, has been done on the basis of these 3 factors: economy, environment, energy security. At the point, the important factor of the issues that need to be observed is that all these 3 are very competing with each other. If you look at the environmentalists, their emphasis is 100% environment. They forget about energy security and they forget about economy. But those who are on practical ground, they probably don't bother much about environment. They more look into the economy. And as a national, from national perspective, energy security is equally important. So to optimize all these three is very important. And we have to understand the presentation that or claims by different people that, you know, this we have to go this way, that way. The focus has to be optimization of these three factors. Now we look into the supply of sustainable primary energy. PE stands for primary energy and the required infrastructure. If you review the 2010 PSMP, there was a power system master plan in 2010 which predicted growth, which predicted supply of primary energy and the kind of power plants that we need to set up. And you can see it's already passed. I mean, it was done in 2010. We are in 2017 now. So we can look back and see where we have failed. And we can see that the gas supply has not been up to the mark what has been asked. And similarly, even local coal supply never met the 1 million threshold in any of the years. So it indicates, and as a result, perhaps, we have not been able to achieve those higher 6 and 7% energy GDP growth in last 5 years. That could be one of the reasons. I'm not saying that is the only reason, but that could be one of the reasons that we could not supply the primary energy that was required for the growth. Now, what is the projection of primary energy growth? Right now, in terms of kiloton of oil equivalent, we are using about 28,000 kiloton of oil equivalent. And by 2041, it will be about 120,000 kiloton of oil equivalent. And if we go as it is, that's a huge requirement. You can imagine how you know, it's almost 4 times more than what we are using today in terms of supplying primary energy. That's a huge challenge. And to reduce the burden of that challenge, it has also suggested that if you go the energy efficiency path, we can reduce 20,000 kiloton of oil equivalent demand. And that is a path we must take. And I will elaborate on that later a little bit. Now let's see what is the supply situation, what is the plan from the government to meet that primary energy supply. Petrobangla has projected the demand of future gas requirement, and that is their calculation. And if you look at the calculation, you can see deep sea, shallow sea, what the president of the chamber has asked for, exploration. They have kept possible production from those exploration. But look at the graph or the area in blues, in big area at the bottom. That is from existing reserve. Right now, we are not seeing any activity that will allow those production to come in. So our planning and preparation has to be based on the deficit. It's on the basis of what we are producing now. And if you look at the deficit, in 2020-21, the deficit is 1875 million cubic feet. In 25, it is about 3,000. And in 2030, which is our target area in SDG achievement, is about 4,500 million cubic feet. And government right now principally thinking of meeting that deficit through LNG import. And this is the situation of the LNG import. By 2018, we are expecting 500 million cubic feet of LNG. And by 2025, about 3,500, where our, if we don't find any more discovery, our deficit is supposed to be 3,000 million cubic feet a day. The government is planning to have 3,500 million cubic feet of LNG import by 2025. And ministry and BPDB is considering many additional projects to add to this supply. This is according to Petrobras. And regarding coal and oil, this is from JICA projection. Not much study has been done that what will require, because the study of requirement depends on the requirement of the electricity, because which is the major consumer of primary energy. And if you look at that, then by 2041, we'll be importing 60 million ton of coal per year. That is the plan according to present plan according to PSMP 2016. But one thing needs to be noted is that if you look at the coal demand, no, it's not very clear here, but from 2028, importing coal will not be adequate. So they have added local coal production from 2028, and that will reach by 2041 about 10 million tons. So by 2041, we will need 70 million tons of coal, according to the present fuel mix, which will allow 35% of the electricity coming from coal in 2041. And in terms of oil import, equivalent of 30 million ton of oil equivalent, 30 million ton of oil equivalent has to be imported by 2041. Right now, our total energy, primary energy supply is 28 to 30 million ton of coal oil equivalent. But by 2041, we'll be importing 30 million ton of oil equivalent of oil and its products, diesel, petrol and other stuff, LPG, LNG. So what are the opportunities? The opportunities, we have looked into the situations, current situations, and what is our plan and projection. The opportunities is to really extensive onshore and offshore exploration activities by IOCs. Why I say IOCs? We have seen the results of BAPEX's only policy for the last 10 years. That has not really worked for us. So we have to review that process and policy, and we'll have to really, I believe personally, is my belief, that we should engage both onshore and offshore IOCs. The experience with IOCs has been fantastic with us. I mean, I don't see anybody saying that, you know, it has been a bad experience with IOC. What is the bad experience? We are buying gas at $3. Instead of importing at current price, it will be $8 for LNG. Of course, the price has gone up. Exploration is difficult now because of the world oil and gas price is low. But we'll have to really explore that. Then, if we want to really increase the capability of BAPEX, we'll have to increase the capability of BAPEX to that extent that they can go and acquire resources for Bangladesh overseas. They can go to Africa, they can go to, you know, Central Asia or all other places and compete with other companies and acquire resources for us. That is the only vision we can have for BAPEX, if we really want to get them to an international standard, an international company. Then we have to take a decision on coal, local coal production, because as I said, by 2028 we will have to have our local supply of coal in addition to the import we will be doing. And to do that, we have to take a decision now, because it will take 7 to 8 years to develop and, you know, go through the process and ultimately start production. So that needs to be done. Infrastructure development for coal import by public sector, this I will elaborate a little more later. Large opportunities for private sector investment in transmission and distribution. Right now, our transmission distribution can efficiently disperse 8,500 megawatt of electricity. It is struggling with 9,000, 9,500, 10,000, 10,500, it will not be able to disperse. Government is working hard. They allocated in 2016 budget, they allocated 16,000 crore taka only for T&D. So it was a late realization, but it will take some time to catch up. But that is where private sector can come in and help government to expedite the process. And then efficiency improvement by 1%, we'll come to that later. Then we come to high quality power system development. This is the demand assessment. In 2020, PSMP 2010 assessed 17,000 peak demand. But PSMB 2016 said it's about 13,000. And government is planning to install 23,000 megawatt of equivalent, 23 megas of production capacity. And then 2030, the PSMP is saying that 33,000, 16 saying 27,000, and then 40,000 is the government plan. This is something I want you to focus on the left-hand side. PSMP 2010 projection of peak demand, let's say for 2015, was about 10,000 megawatt. But if you look at the PDB data, it says 7,800 megawatt. That's real data. That peak demand went up to 7,800 megawatt. There is a huge discrepancy. The reason is PDB's demand forecast that is being told to us is a fictitious number. It is not a true number. And because of that, they maintain that number on record, those demands are there. Actual demand was much more. Today they are saying that the demand, we are producing 9,000 megawatt, the demand is 9,200 or 8,000, you know, 8,900 or something, so there is no load shedding. So to hide the load shedding, they are manipulating the data, and that is creating problem for the planners to do the planning in future. So we have to be truthful, we have to know, tell that what is the real demand, and that can be easily done. Mismatch in fuel import infrastructure and generation planning. If you look at the coal planning, there are about 12,000 megawatt of coal generation plan is on the paper or of, at different stages of, you know, approval process. Some of have been already approved, some are under evaluation, some are in the planning. There is 12,000 megawatt. There has been no coal import facility yet. So if you have huge import-based power plant planning, and if you don't focus on the import part of that, which is facilities of infrastructure, then obviously your all power plant will be sitting there and not progress much. In the same way, in the planning, about 2,500 megawatt dual fuel. Dual fuels are all diesel and gas. Gas and diesel. Right now, 1,700 megawatt of power plant is stranded because of lack of supply of gas. In addition to that, if we have 25,000 megawatt dual fuel, even huge LNG import may not be able to service those plants. And we'll have to depend on diesel. So this is the status of the coal projects right now. Payra, we are hoping that Payra, 1320 megawatt Payra, will come on stream by 2019. And if that 1320 can come by 2019, that will be a huge relief for the government. It is very challenging, very difficult, but I tell you, sticking to a plan helps. Sticking to a plan of fuel mix, kind of what kind of, you know, required the entire system planning, all those kind of things, that helps to avoid some of this mismatch that we have seen. It reduces the uncertainty. This we all know, fuel type right now. Because of the delay of the coal plants, about 3,000 megawatt of new oil-based power plant has been in the process of approval. Opportunity. I have been proposing this for a long time, and I'm taking this opportunity to again propose to switch from conventional planning to integrated resource planning. Integrated resource planning focuses on system cost reduction, minimum system cost, instead of minimum generation cost. It focuses on distributed system, it focuses on bottom-up approach of prediction, and in 22 states in USA, it is by law that the planners have to use integrated resource planning. Many countries do that formally or informally. We should now look into, we have been doing conventional planning, and if you go and look into the integrated resource planning, actually PSMB 2016 took a lot of element from integrated resource planning in its planning. So I appreciate that, that is relatively a much better plan than any plan we have done in the past. And
big problem in terms of talking point, in terms of government planning, is lack of data, especially consumers data. We don't have much consumer data. So I think a central depository of data is an opportunity right now to develop so that we can easily track the growth path and its requirement. And then gradual transition to a smart grid. All right, I'll go through quickly. Very good news for the government. Crude oil price forecast and LNG price forecast seems to be quite flat. Crude oil lowest range is 55 by 2022, 55 dollar per barrel to $66 per barrel, and LNG, Japan LNG import is predicted by up to 2023 to be flat at $7, which is very good news for the government, because they will have some breathing space with all these oil-based power plants to go into the actual optimum fuel mix. They have some little more time. Current rate of industry, this is the rate, but industry in future price projection, after showing this, I would like to say that in future price projection, industry must be involved in the understanding of supply, planning, and pricing, and how to increase the price gradually so that industry has enough time to prepare and adjust. These are just numbers. This is the LNG price situation. We are talking about affordable pricing. Currently, the weighted average gas price of Petrobangla is $2.20 per 1,000 cubic feet. And if we import at $7, and if the mix is 500 million per day import and 2,700 local supply at $2.20, the resulting price will be $3.23. If it is $8, it will be $3.41. This exercise has been done by Petrobangla. So, average weighted average price, to take it from $2.20 to $3.40, there will be some price shock, but I think it is doable. Government can do it, increase the price of gas to such extent so that the import price of LNG, if it is at $8, can be adjusted with the market without much difficulty. Now, price prediction, this I've done an exercise myself. In 2025, if the local supply is 2400 million, that is the total requirement, about 4800 million cubic feet per day. And import is 2400 at $10, then the resulting price will be $6 per MCF by 2025. And by 2030, the local supply is 1200, the import is 4000, and the resulting price would be $8.02, assuming $10 LNG price and $2 local price. And the electricity tariff, it has been shown in PSMB 2015 that by 2041, the tariff will be about 13 taka per kilowatt hour. Fuel mix is very important, and one thing to be noted, that by 2041, according to the present plan, more than 90% of the energy for electricity production will be imported. Opportunities in pricing. Historical low fossil fuel price allows the GOB to adjust the local fuel price to international price. This I have been asking for a long time. Let the local price come to the international price and be, you know, through a transparent formula, let it be the, let the price, so that the subsidy issue is gone forever. If they want to give subsidy, they can give direct subsidy in future if the price goes up. But fossil fuel price is not going to go up very soon, so this is a good opportunity for government to adjust the price to the local price. It also allows the government to predict future gas price and electricity price for the industry and general public with confidence. Because of this price, because oil is going to play a big role, I think government should come up with a prediction, price prediction for the next 5 years or next 10 years, so that the industry feels at ease and they can plan. It's very important for them to feel at ease and plan. Renewable, number of studies has been done, wind energy, has minimal to zero opportunity in Bangladesh because there is no wind source. Lot of people say a lot of things. Please verify yourself and find out whether there is any opportunity or not. Current technology Bangladesh requires 300 to 400 acre, 350 to 400 acre land for 100 megawatt solar plant. So land is a big problem, biz restriction, especially in getting in one chunk. So the dream of having 10,000 megawatt power plant, solar power plant in Bangladesh, I'm not very convinced on that. Biogas has a good option for quality energy for the rural area. Government can give subsidy and help it. And rooftop solar should be promoted. That has huge potential and opportunity, rooftop solar. And government should really come up with a policy so that they can focus on rooftop solar. This is a study done by SREDA and World Bank in 2015. And the maximum potential of renewable is shown here, 3,600, including all sources. So, you know, you hear all kind of competing numbers depending on individual agenda, you know. So we have to be realistic. This is based on ground reality. Maybe we can add another 1,500 and say 5,000 total opportunity, or maybe 10,000, but not 20,000, 30,000. I don't see that in Bangladesh. Our opportunity actually lies in the efficiency improvement. If we go for efficiency improvement, just 1% per year for the next 20 years, we have opportunity to reduce the demand by more than 20%. And that is real opportunity. You have to invest. Relatively low investment will give us a much better food. I have already discussed the last point here I want to discuss is that we should try to maximize import from neighboring countries. That is a fantastic renewable energy opportunity for me. We don't have to use the land, we don't have to invest, we have no pollution, we are just getting finished electricity from neighbors. That is adding to renewable requirement. So government has done a very good job securing 600, they are going for another 500, and the plan is to get 9,000 from neighbors by 2041. And that's a great opportunity. I'm leaving the nuclear here outside my discussion. If the panels or the discussion want to discuss nuclear, they can discuss. And the last but not the least is the human resource development. Scarcity of mid and top level managers with technical background, shortage of skilled technical work. Today, just today in Prothomalo, I saw that in government sector itself, 36 lakh, 3.6 million skilled worker deficiency. 3.6 million in government sector, where we are the second leader in the world, skilled labor deficiency. So how will you achieve 7-8% growth unless you have human resource development? And human resource development needs a national planning cell with ministerial supervision. Is more than overdue now. It's required. We have to focus on human resource development. We can talk about our human resource availability. We can talk about the quality of our human resources, but that needs to be really understood, discussed, and focused on to improve. So I cannot give any more emphasis than human resource development for achieving our, because it is the human that converts resources to wealth. Resources to wealth does not get converted by itself. You require human intervention. And if you don't have quality human resources, nothing will happen. We will not go anywhere. And that was it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was indeed interesting and a very valuable presentation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have the interesting part of this session now. We have panel discussion, and in the panel we have Dr. Salim Mahmood, energy, law and policy expert and former member of Bangladesh Energy Regulatory Commission, Dr. Ahsan H. Mansoor, Executive Director, Policy Research Institute, PRI, Mr. Mullah M. Amjad Hussain, Editor, Energy and Power, Dr. Mushfiqur Rahman, Technical Director, Roopur Nuclear Power Plant, and Engineer Rizwanul Kabir, Managing Director, ECPV Chittagong Limited. And this panel discussion will be followed by open discussion session, which will be moderated by Dr. M. Fauzul Kabir Khan, the former Secretary, Power Division, Ministry of Power, Energy and Mineral Resources, Government of Bangladesh. This is over to you, Mr. Fauzul Kabir Khan.
Yes, thank you very much. It was a very interesting presentation, setting in the good background for the for further discussion. We have a very distinguished panel of discussants representing the government, they're representing research institutions, representing the media, and the private sector. So without further ado, I would request Dr. Salim Mahmood, energy and policy expert and former member of BRC to make his start his discussion.
It's not good. Honorable Chair, Honorable Chief Guest, Dr. Taufiq Ilahi Choudhury, BP Governor, whom I regard as my teacher, dignitaries, participants from various sectors and business leaders. Thank you for inviting me as a panel discussion. At the very outset, I will touch an issue which is basically the policy issue. Actually, you have seen that in the energy and power sector, historically, our policy was faulty. I mean, about 25 to 30 years ago, we must have adopted the policy of diversification. And in energy policy, diversification is the key, which the present government has successfully, I mean, adopted the policy of diversification. And the long-term plan for our energy sector, which the present government has adopted, based on the fuel mix is based on existing gas, coal, LNG, cross-border power trade, renewables, and the exploration and production part of the oil and gas. I think the basic feature of the diversification policy of the present government is correct. Professor Tamim, I thank Professor Tamim for his very enlightening deliberations. He correctly mentioned that the future plan of the government for the energy sector based on the fuel mix is, I think, acceptable, where the imported coal has a very important role. You must have noticed that recently a pressure group called Oil, Gas, Electricity and Port Protection Committee, they have presented an alternative long-term plan for the energy sector. And surprisingly, they have projected that the future plan of our energy sector that should be based on our indigenous gas. And it's very surprising. I think they have replicated a plan which was drafted by Nixon in 2006, the power system master plan. Initially it was drafted by Nixon, an American company. They have projected that by 2020, at least 20,000 megawatt of electricity must have been produced from local gas, which is really absurd and faulty. I think they have copied and replicated the idea of the Nixon that has been abandoned by the government recently. So the policy of based on fuel mix is very important. I think we are on the right track at the moment. Another important issue is the pricing. From the deliberation of Professor Tamim, we have seen the pricing. Historically, our pricing policy was based on the philosophy of political economy, and the politicization was the key. And the success of the present, the planner of the energy sector, the present government is that they have, I must thank Dr. Taufik Ilahi Chowdhury, who has an enormous contribution for this issue. The government has successfully depoliticized the pricing policy. You know, and you'll be noticing that when I was in Regulatory Commission as a member, we adjusted the gas price after 6 years. The interval was 6 years. So, the production price that was adjusted after 11 years, production price of gas. The pricing, for pricing, you know, depoliticization is important because while I was doing my PhD at the university in energy policy, I have studied that pricing is always a nuisance, it's called positive nuisance, initially in the OECD countries. And but this nuisance is very necessary for the economy. And the Regulatory Commission and the government, we had been very successful in dismantling the issue of politicization from the energy policy. And another issue is that actually, I think it is the, I must take the responsibility as a former regulator that the Regulatory Commission has been, we failed to address the pricing issue correctly. And there are basically two principles of pricing. One is opportunity cross pricing, and another is cost-based pricing. In power sector, we basically adopted the cost-based pricing, which was basically faulty. And also in the gas pricing, we adopted a policy which is neither an opportunity cost approach or even a cost-based approach. For us, we have understood that in gas pricing, there are two methods for pricing. One is bottom-up, another is top-down. Bottom-up is basically the first, the regulator must calculate the affordability of the consumers, the distribution costs and other costs, and then at the end, the cost of the upstream would be added. And initially in the gas industry, that was a very popular approach, but during 1980s deregulation, most of the countries have withdrawn from this policy. Now, the ideal situation, the benchmark pricing internationally adopted, is the top-down. At the first instance, the regulator must look into the cost in the upstream, and because in the gas industry we call it gas value chain, there is a very strong connection between the upstream and downstream. So, actually we have started in Bangladesh recently, but I think still we have many things to do. There is another very important issue, which is a contractual issue. I mean, you have seen in the power sector, there are various contracts, IPP, rental, quick rental, and different contracts. My time is okay. The IPPs are long-term contract, and there are also short-term contracts, basically rental, quick rental. I think for an ideal energy policy, there has to be a benchmark with regard to contracts. Like I'm citing a example from Indian power policy. The Indian power policy prescribes that 50 to 60% contracts must be long-term contracts, 25 contracts must be short-term, and 15% contracts should be based on power trading. In our country, actually, as you have noticed, that about 29 to 30% power contracts are basically, for liquid fuel contracts, and I'm sure the government will consider that these contracts should be for short-term contracts, and that will, although we are having an advantage of low oil price internationally at the moment, but still there is a risk. So the government should think to redesign the contracts, and that oil-based power contracts can be for 5 years and extendable. The government will have the discretion not to extend. So it will save money for the government. The government will also can also think to introduce power trading in our country, and our neighbor India has started it for the last one decade. There is also some legal challenges in the Regulatory Commission. We have seen that while the government entities and the private sector, they sign contracts, and we found that sometimes they do not have any long-term projection, long-term prediction, what will happen after 10 years, 15 years. So the drafters of the contracts should be very aware, and I think there has to be involvement of the expert, legal experts. And the cross-border power trade is very important. I'm sure that the government is addressing this issue very carefully.
Yes, may I request you to... Okay. Finish quickly, because you see we are having a time overrun of about 15 minutes like power projects, so we'll try to expedite. So I would request the next presenters to limit their discussion within 5 minutes. Okay, thank you very much. Our next discussion is Dr. Hassan Mansoor, Executive Director, Policy Research Institute.
Good morning, and thank you all. I'll just go straight into the subject matter. Certainly, some progress has been made in Bangladesh in the power sector. There's no denial to that fact. However, in particular, capacity increase has been significant, and that's partly through this, which what we call high-cost, quick generation, quick response rental power plants. But we're still facing numerous challenges, as illustrated by Dr. Tamim, and we all also familiar with that, that despite, and there are some challenges as well, we are producing 15,000 megawatt, or close, we have the installed capacity of 15,000 megawatt, but we are producing less than 9,000. So there is a huge efficiency issue that needs to be addressed. We cannot install so much capacity and actually produce so little, and that is not affordable for a capital poor country like Bangladesh. We have to be much more resource efficient in our production capacity and generation mix. Distribution challenges are also enormous. We know that particularly in rural areas, the challenges are, basically you have electricity connection by name, but in reality, the availability of electricity is very limited. So that challenge is very much there. Government is targeting for 100% coverage of all villages in Bangladesh under electricity, which is very welcome. But it has to be quality electricity, not just connection. We don't want the khambas, but we want also the actual electricity flowing through those pillars. So that's the challenge that government has to face. Progress in implementing large power plant is painfully slow. We have seen even recently that new quick rental type power plants are being, tenders are being floated. That's pathetic. Why should it be like that after 7 years of reasonably long of involvement with the power sector development? Why should you even be considering floating short-term tenders for this kind of low capacity in installation of our power projects? I don't see any reason. This is high cost, and that is must be avoided. So we must have to accelerate progress with our large power plants. Now, I see some major discrepancy between the power sector master plan and the economic plan that the government is formulating. The power sector master plan, if you look at the numbers that Tamim showed, and I also checked it separately before, the 2016 one envisages that the economic growth will peak between 2020 and 2025 at 7.4%, which is almost the level that the government is saying that we have achieved. Now, thereafter, the growth tapers off, and it comes back to only 4.4% by 2041. I will question, how does that growth scenario compare with Bangladesh becoming a middle-income country by 2031, upper middle-income country by 2031? Upper middle-income country, we will require at least $5,500 per capita income. And our growth rate, we have done the calculations, our growth rate has to be sustained at above 8% level between 2021 and 2031. The 10-year period, the average growth rate has to be at least 8%. So where is the consistency between the demand projections that we are seeing here in the master plan and the national aspiration that we want to be an upper middle income country by 2031? It's a fundamental difference. The demand projections that's coming out of it is completely out of line with the government's ambitions for making the country upper middle income by 2031 and high income country by 2041. That's simply not there. Secondly, I would say that I don't have much time, so I will cut down my presentation, that optimum utilization in electricity trade is perhaps our best available option among with the investment plans for large power plants. I will not go into the coal controversy because coal controversy is a serious one. We cannot exploit our own coal. And I can write it down, if we cannot use our coal now, that coal will be lost forever. Because the coal, like the Stone Age was not finished because of shortage of stone, similarly, this fossil fuel age will not be finished because of shortage of fossil fuel, but because of technological innovation. So our coal will remain under the ground, not for posterity, but lost for all generations. So this is the loss that we are incurring for whatever political reason, I don't know. But that is a huge economic cost for that kind of political decision that we are not taking into account, and we should. I would emphasize again on the electricity power trade with India. I have seen it, how good it is done, how well managed it is done in between relationship between Canada and US, and extensive purchase back and forth going on between states of Canada and states of US. And in general, US is a net importer of power from Canada. So that's a very positive thing. We should learn from that experience. The positive thing is that Bangladesh is also moving in that direction. So far, we have seen commitment of more than 1,000 megawatt. I think it should go much faster and quicker because, first of all, electricity price by the private producers in India is falling. The spot market price now is less than 5 rupees in India, and solar prices are collapsing in India, and the market is collapsing in India, and we can benefit from that. I don't believe that Bangladesh has much of a solar energy future. We have to import from India. And India has a huge solar potential, and the prices are collapsing. We can use the spot market. What is needed there is the government intervention to have regulatory improvement so that our private sector can import it, our government sector can import it. There should not be a monopoly of the government to import that power.
If you could...
yes, I will cut down. So I will emphasize on that aspect, and I will also make one more point, final point, is that some people will say, well, with Indian trade with India, we have increased our energy security vulnerability. I don't believe that, because we will still have significant excess capacity as in our production capacity. So in the event of an extreme crisis, if that thing is halted, we can still fall back on our excess capacity, generation capacity, to cover that shortfall. So we should prudently manage it. Up to 20-25%, we can safely go with Indian electricity at a cheaper cost and no environmental hazard to ourselves. Thank you very much.
We have open discussion, so if you want to participate in the open discussion, please pass on your business card. Not now. Okay, so may I now request Mr. Molla M. Amjad Hussain, Editor, Energy and Power, to join the discussion. Again, please try to complete your discussion within 5 minutes. Thank you.
Good morning. আমি আসলে বাংলায় বলতে চাই। প্রেজেন্টেশনের একটা জায়গাতে বলা হয়েছে সঠিক তথ্য না পাওয়ার কারণে পরিকল্পনার বিভ্রাট ঘটছে। আমি 2010 সালে দিদেন বাংলাদেশ বিদ্যুৎ উন্নয়ন বোর্ডের চেয়ারম্যানের একটা প্রেজেন্টেশনকে রেফার করতে চাই। উনি 2010 প্রেজেন্টেশনে বলেছিলেন যে 2014 সালে বিদ্যুতের উৎপাদন খরচ কমে 3.91 টাকায় চলে আসবে। তার আগের বছর 13-তে এই উৎপাদন খরচ বৃদ্ধি পেয়ে হবে 3.74 টাকা। তার কারণ হচ্ছে 2014 শুরু থেকে আমাদের বেজলোড পাওয়ার প্ল্যান্টগুলো আসা শুরু হবে এবং আমরা খুব সাশ্রয়ী দামে কয়লাভিত্তিক বিদ্যুৎ পাব, বিধায় আমাদের উৎপাদন খরচ কমে আসবে। এখন বাংলাদেশের বিদ্যুতের উৎপাদন খরচ 6.29 টাকা বা 30 পয়সার মতন, কিন্তু সরকারের ভর্তুকি সহ বাল্ক বিক্রি দাম এর চেয়ে বেশ কম। আমার প্রশ্ন হচ্ছে, আমি প্রত্যাশা করি না যে 40 বছর আগের দামে বিদ্যুৎ বা গ্যাস বা অন্য জ্বালানি পাওয়া যাবে, কিন্তু একটি দেশের ইকোনমি এবং দেশের রপ্তানি যোগ্য খাত কি দামে জ্বালানি কিনে ভবিষ্যতে প্রতিযোগিতায় টিকে থাকতে পারবে, এটার একটি দীর্ঘমেয়াদী প্রজেকশন অবশ্যই দরকার। তার কারণ এখন ক্যাপটিভ পাওয়ারে বিদ্যুতের গ্যাসের দাম প্রায় 4 টাকা, এখন এভারেজ গ্যাস প্রাইস 3-4, ক্যাপটিভে গ্যাসের দাম $4, এভারেজ গ্যাস প্রাইস $3, কিন্তু এলএনজি আমদানি করে আমি যদি এলএনজিকে ট্যাক্স ফ্রি করি, সাবসিডি দিই, তারপরও ওয়েটেড এভারেজ প্রাইস $6 মধ্যে সীমিত রাখাও কষ্টকর হবে, তখন কি আমি $4 ক্যাপটিভে গ্যাস দিতে পারব? বিশেষ করে দেশের বস্ত্র খাত যারা ক্যাপটিভের উপর প্রায় পুরোটাই নির্ভরশীল, তারা কি এই $6 বা $8 বা $10 গ্যাস ক্যাপটিভে নিয়ে সামাল দিতে পারবে কিনা? প্রথম প্রশ্ন। দ্বিতীয় প্রশ্ন, আমরা বলছি নতুন করে ক্যাপটিভের জন্য গ্যাস সংযোগ দেয়া যাচ্ছে না যৌক্তিক কারণে, কারণ প্রাকৃতিক গ্যাসের সরবরাহ নেই। এর বিপরীতে বলা হচ্ছে যে শিল্পকে আনইন্টারাপ্টেড এবং কোয়ালিটি পাওয়ার সাপ্লাই সরকার এনশিওর করবে, কিন্তু এটার জন্য আর কতদিন লাগবে, এটা আসলে আজকের সবচেয়ে বড় প্রশ্ন। তৃতীয়ত, 2025 সাল পর্যন্ত আমাদের যে পরিকল্পনা, যদি এই পরিবর্তিত ডেডলাইনে কয়লাভিত্তিক বিদ্যুৎ কেন্দ্রগুলো যদি উৎপাদনে আসে, যদিও সরকারের পক্ষ থেকে পরিবর্তিত পরিকল্পনায় পিডিবির তথ্য অনুসারে প্রায় 22,000 মেগাওয়াট কয়লাভিত্তিক বিদ্যুৎ কেন্দ্র করার কথা বলা হচ্ছে, প্রফেসর তামিম তার প্রেজেন্টেশনে এখানে দেখিয়েছেন 11,000 প্রায় 12,000 মেগাওয়াট পাওয়ার প্ল্যান্ট, এবং তার অগ্রগতিও বলা হয়েছে। হয়তো আমরা প্রত্যাশা করছি যে পায়রা সবার আগে আসবে, কিন্তু বিদ্যুতের দাম কি হবে? নর্মালি আমাদের নিজস্ব কয়লা যেহেতু রাজনৈতিক কারণে উঠানোর সিদ্ধান্ত আমরা এখনও নেইনি, যার কারণে আমদানি করা কয়লা দিয়ে বিদ্যুৎ উৎপাদন করলে এর খরচ নিজস্ব কয়লা ব্যবহারের চেয়ে কমপক্ষে 25-40% পর্যন্ত বেশি পড়বে। তাহলে আমরা লো কস্ট কোল ব্যবহার করছি কম দামে বিদ্যুৎ পাওয়ার জন্য। আমদানি করা কয়লা আমাদের এই সুবিধাটা দিতে পারবে কিনা? প্রশ্ন হচ্ছে, এখন পর্যন্ত এই কয়লা আমদানির ক্ষেত্রে যে ইনফ্রাস্ট্রাকচার লাগবে, যেটা মাতার বাড়িতে পরিকল্পনা করা আছে কোল ট্রান্সশিপমেন্ট পোর্ট, এটার কাজ এখনও কমপ্লিট হয়নি, যার কারণে মাতার বাড়ি মানে পায়রা এবং রামপাল বিদ্যুৎ কেন্দ্র যদি উৎপাদনে আসে, মানে উৎপাদনের যোগ্যতা অর্জনও করে, বাণিজ্যিক উৎপাদনের সক্ষমতা অর্জনও করে, তাহলে কয়লার যোগান আসবে কি না, বা এই কয়লা আমরা এখন যে দামে প্রেডিক্ট করছি এই পরিবহন কস্ট বেড়ে যেয়ে তার চেয়ে অনেক বেশি হয়ে যাবে কি না, এই বিষয়টি দেখা দরকার। আমি আর একটি কথা বলে শেষ করব, সেটা হচ্ছে যে আমাদের এখন বলা হচ্ছে যে আমাদের টোটাল বিদ্যুৎ উৎপাদন ক্ষমতা 15,379 মেগাওয়াট, কিন্তু অধিকাংশ ক্ষেত্রে এটা উল্লেখ করা হচ্ছে না, এর সাথে যোগ আছে 2,300 মেগাওয়াট ক্যাপটিভ পাওয়ার, যার কারণে এই 15,000 মেগাওয়াট প্লাস আমাদের যে অ্যাকচুয়াল প্রোডাকশন আমরা জেনারেশন পাচ্ছি 9,000 প্লাস, সেটার মধ্যে একটা দ্বিধা তৈরি হচ্ছে যে আসলে প্রকৃত আমাদের এত ক্ষমতা, আমরা এত কম উৎপাদন করছি কেন। তো এই বিষয়টা ক্লিয়ার করা দরকার, এবং গভর্নমেন্ট যখন তার প্ল্যানিং পারপাসে বলছে শুধু সংখ্যার কৃতিত্ব না নিয়ে এই ক্যাপটিভ পাওয়ারটাকে বাদ দিয়ে 13,000 প্লাস মেগাওয়াট যে আমাদের ইয়ে, এবং গ্যাসের ব্যবহার যে কমিয়ে নিয়ে আসা যাচ্ছে, এখন বিদ্যুৎ উৎপাদনে গ্যাসের অবদান 62% মতন, সেখানে লিকুইড ফুয়েল এখন পর্যন্ত যেটা আমাদের 3,000 মেগাওয়াট ক্ষমতা থাকায় এটা হচ্ছে 29%, কিন্তু নতুন করে ইতোমধ্যে 1,200 বা 700 মেগাওয়াটের ওয়ার্ক অর্ডার দেওয়া হয়েছে এবং আরও 3,000 মেগাওয়াটের জন্যে কাজ করা হচ্ছে। সো এই লিকুইড ফুয়েল বেস পাওয়ার প্ল্যান্ট আসার পর আমাদের গ্যাসের অবদান আরও কমে আসবে, বিদ্যুতের উৎপাদন খরচ আরও বাড়বে। তো সো আমরা 90% আমদানি নির্ভর জ্বালানিতে যাচ্ছি, এর মধ্যে একটি ভালো ইন্ডিকেশন ক্রস বর্ডার পাওয়ার ট্রেড, এটা হয়তো বাড়বে। এই ছাড়া এই জ্বালানি আমদানি নির্ভরতা আগামী দিনে জ্বালানির দাম কী হবে, এই বিষয়টি কিন্তু সরকারের পক্ষ থেকে এখনই পূর্বাভাস দেওয়া উচিত, না হলে দেশকে বড় একটা সংকটে পড়তে হবে। ধন্যবাদ আপনাদের।
I would now request Dr. Mushfiqur Rahman, Technical Director, Institute of Rupur Nuclear Power Plant. So please kindly limit. We are really having time overrun. I have about 20 or 30 people want to present, join the open discussion. So, and also we'd like to hear our distinguished chief guest and the special guest. So please limit your presentation within 5 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, Honorable Chair, and thank you, Honorable Moderator. I'd not be repeating a lot of issues that I intended to speak out. Brilliant presentation Dr. Tamim had made, and he focused the statistical manipulation and the gaps that we have been facing consistently, and especially in terms of the power generation and the primary energy supply issues has been focused. I think one of the major issues of power generation is struggling because of the constraint of the primary energy and unutilized primary energy source, that is the domestic coal. We decided not to touch, and sometimes we have been propagating that we may keep it for the future, and Dr. Hassan Mansoor has rightly emphasized that it's not that shortages of the primary energy, but because of the technology evolution that would possibly wane over in the future, some of the energies will never possibly utilize. And Bangladesh may be very unfortunate if we do not focus on coal development right now. Unfortunately, we have been planning for the coal, and we have been planning from the sources like Indonesia, Australia and South Africa, their major exporters. But we are talking about the affordable price of imported coal. On the other hand, we are talking about the sustainable coal development, the supercritical technologies, which will obviously require the clean coal, that is low sulfur, high energy, and low ash coal. Bangladesh has one of the best quality coal under the ground, and we could possibly extract them at a competitive price. Unfortunately, again, the neglected sector of coal never been receiving any attention by our policy planners, and never been tried to even evaluate how much cost the coal extraction would ask for in Bangladesh, and whether there is a competitive analysis of domestic coal extraction and import coal utilization for power generation. I'm afraid there is no reliable statistics, neither any information to the policy makers. And because of this information gap, the policy makers often try not to touch upon these issues. I also have the concern that the projection of the future coal prices in Indonesia, Australia is not going to be limited within $60. Right now, if you take the international credible statistics, it's almost $79 in Indonesia, and excuse me, that's 5,900 kilocalorie coal per kg. On the contrary, if you take the clean coal, Australia, it is $114 FOB. And the future projection says it is coming nearly to $70 FOB. Add up the cost of transportation and duties and taxes, and it will be touching around $80, $90. And with that $90 per ton coal, whether you can produce the competitive power, that's a big issue. And rightly emphasized by Dr. Tamim, the non-availability or even absence of the infrastructure facilitation that requires for the import of the coal, that is one of the major impediments. And it has to be started now, otherwise how you can facilitate the primary energy supply that would provide you the secondary energy, that is energy, coal-based energy. So these are the mismatch, and unfortunately I'm repeating the same, that is coal has been neglected since the discovery of coal in the early 60s. We are blessed with more than 3 billion ton best quality coal in the world, and unfortunately we are struggling with the primary energy supply, and that obviously leads us to the mismatch in fuel mix, sustainable, affordable energy development. I just would finish in one additional point, that when we are talking about the import-based coal development in the on the coastal areas of Bangladesh, we are talking about balancing an affordable, reliable, and sustainable energy development. Contrary, when we are talking about the domestic coal development issues, we are always focusing or over-focusing the environment issues. I think this is an issue to be addressed seriously if we really talk about affordable and sustainable and reliable energy supply. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mushfiqur Rahman. Our last panel discussion is Engineer Rizwan Kabir. He's from the private sector. Managing Director, ECPV Chittagong Limited.
Good morning. Thank you very much, GCCI, for giving me a chance. I think I'm the most unknown person here, so hopefully you'll have a common man's voice from me. I have nothing to add with the very educated and capable panelists. But what I think that what Professor Tamim told, that if we look at our energy mix, which is 75%, I just want to add up one thing, that 75% dependent on natural gas today, because it's not only power, but many other segments are dependent on natural gas. So I'll ask today's discussion that how we can divert this dependency to other fuel mix. This is a very good thing that DCCI has started talking about energy, because we are too much dependent on power, and we have improved power situation very well. We have handled power situation very well, but maybe we need to think of one step back. What is the energy we may have to produce power and also meet the demand for energy, other energy hungry activities? If we look at, as we are from private sector, I think we are capable, or we have proved our worth in a sense that more than 50% of grid power today are coming from IPPs. So thanks to the IPPs, and also thanks to the friendly policies from government and other regulators, that today's power situation stability is a joint partnership between the government, public and private sector enterprises. Now, if we think of energy, why don't that kind of policies we try to develop and create a situation where private sector can also participate? I totally agree that we need to have coal, we need to have IOCs in Bangladesh, because until we have our own energy, is really, really a difficult situation for us to sustain and achieve our SDG goals or middle income to developed nation. All the coal projects, why is not happening? You know, the financing in coal projects are heavily dependent on the environmental issues. And being India, we are being just beside India and other Indonesia and other big nations. All the private sector coal projects today are struggling for the financing issues. Very few countries in the world, and also multilateral agencies, they are not interested to finance coal projects. With this situation, if we go for coal projects with imported coal, I'm pretty sure that in a long-term competitiveness, I don't think these projects will be competitive with imported coal. Many people talked about investing in offshore coal blocks from the government or creating facilities, but I think it's very important to discover our own reserves, and definitely be cost competitive in the energy mix. Energy should not be that much important. And we should facilitate IOCs. If we can buy LNG at almost $8 to $11 projected, because we haven't calculated all the other adding up issues like taxes, regasification charges, and so many other issues in inland transportation, pipeline transportation. So it could be $10 to $11. And then we'll increase our gas mix to today's $3 to $3.50 to $5. Then what will happen to the captive industry? Captive industry is paying $3, $3.50 to gas companies today. So with LNG, it could be $6, it could be $7. And then what will happen to our textile industry? We're heavily dependent on textile. And you know, we are going ahead together with China and India for the textile industry. So if there is a problem in energy prices, energy efficiency, energy supply, definitely that's going to hit textile industry. I think on the other hand, we have very much opportunities to develop ourselves, have a policy frame so that private sector can participate in onshore discoveries and further augmentation. Private sector has a limited access to further strengthening the gas resources, coal resources, and then in the energy supply chain. Deregulation should be there in the energy supply chain, and I think on the renewable side, there could be some policy frameworks. Local governments should be strengthened. We need to clean the cities. Not only, we have to, we can also utilize this biogas and biomass, and this is a country of so much population. I think today or tomorrow, that is the need, that we have to clean the country and we have to use the biomass we have. So again, a policy reform is required. I think I once again thank you very much. It's a very limited time. I wish in future we can have much more questions. Will actually help us to find out a way, and definitely we will have a platform to participate from private sector and every other sector. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rizwan, Engineer Rizwan Al-Kabir. So we now move on to the open discussion part. We have about 20 names and we have a time overrun of 20 minutes. So we have to limit all your remarks to 2 minutes, including that of mine. Okay. And also, if you could avoid repeats of what others have said. So we'll begin with Rear Admiral M. Khalid Iqbal, Chairman Chittagong Port Authority. Sure. Okay, there'll be mic. Concordance mic.
DCCI volunteers, please help with the microphones. Can we have 2 volunteers on both sides?
Thank you very much. I would like to straight away come to the point. I would take the cue from what Professor Dr. Tamim has said, especially regarding the infrastructure development, because that is one of my prime area, being the port chairman. If we consider the 3 things, the landing of the in the fuel for the energy, the storage and the transportation from Chittagong, we know that almost 100% of any kind of fuel for the energy that is being used, which is imported, that is always landing in and around Chittagong. So just I would like to give a few of our visions that we are trying to do. First principle that we follow is, if the port cannot arrange the landing facilities, we facilitate the private sectors to develop their own facilities. And that's not only inside the Chittagong port, that also involves other coastal areas, starting from Sitakunda to Maheshkal areas. A number of private companies have applied either for the LNG, the LPG terminals, both FSRU and the shore base. So we are trying to facilitate them, trying to bring that particular area under the port limit, because you know that once it is within the port limit, the conservation and other service support facilities automatically come. So I would like to clear the request here, that especially the Energy Ministry and other concerned, that depending on our future demand, clear of any type of request here, the fuel for the energy is important, that put the demand the energy ministry more closely between our ministries, that what is the exact demand,
depending
so that
on our future
public
demand,
sector, we can develop our own facilities here. As of now, we have the facilities for first FSRU, that is Accelerate, has been already they have already signed the MU, and the Accelerate and Summit, they are going to sign their own internal MU, because they are going to have a cluster of FSRU within 2 to 3 kilometers of the Sonadia. So here we also need to see.
Thank you.
So my last point is that please forward some of the recommendations so that we can develop our own facilities in and around Chittagong. And later on maybe I can contribute more. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Next I would invite Mr. Khairul Majid Mahmood, Managing Director Caldwell.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Chair, for giving me the opportunity.
Tamim has said, especially regarding the infrastructure development. Tamim has said, especially regarding the infrastructure development, because that is one of my prime area, being the port chairman.
Presented your information, I think there is a huge gap. You know, when Bill Clinton was here, we were supposed to sell gas. The expertise said we had excess of 16 trillion. Cubic feet gas. Where in the world those gas are today? So our current Prime Minister at that time didn't agree to sell gas. What would have happened? Now we have dual fuel, we have coal fired, all these alternatives. All I understand that our infrastructure in energy sector, we don't have grid line, we don't have substations. Simultaneously we have to do this. 22,000 megawatt capacity, all we have in our grid line right now. But we are planning by 2030, whatever we see over here. And it is, I understand, in energy sector, Nuclear, I thought we'll hear more from about nuclear from this gentleman of Rupur, but he talked about gas, unfortunately. We were all eager to know about nuclear energy, how it's, you know, going to facilitate in the future, but you talked in different direction. I understand for us to reach our GDP growth, these are the resources. Dr. Mansoor
Tamim has said, importing especially media, regarding the importing, infrastructure development, because that is one
we
of
have
my
resources. Yes, we don't have much land, but tell me, Mr. Prime Minister,
being the port chairman,
so far in green
if we consider
energy,
that
we don't have a single megawatt, be it solar. Yes, there's little wind power, absolutely not. Hydro, impossible. But there are opportunities in solar. It's a global policy that 10% of the energy sector have to be green energy. You're talking about Rampal and all these things, but you have to think of blue economy and a lot of other criteria for us to survive in the future. Why not? There are hundreds of proposals with PDB.
Thank you, Mr. Mahmood.
Not a single proposal, just a second, sir, so far has produced. Your tariff started from 17 cents, now you have come down to 12.5 cents. India is giving free land, so their cost will be less, Mr. Advisor, tariff. So when Mr. Mansoor says that we can import from India, everything we don't have to do import from India, we can do it on our own. Thank you very much for your time.
Okay, our next discussant would be Mr. Asif Ibrahim, former president DCI, and also founder chairman BILD.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I would like to congratulate Tamim Bhai for a good presentation. The thing that I would like to highlight first is, I think as the government has set out plans for special economic zones, keeping in mind that future investments in industries will be in the special economic zones, I would like to hear from the Honorable Advisor, what are our plans to secure energy in these zones? And whether we are they going to be producing on their own? If so, what materials will they use? That's my first question. Second question is that Dr. Mansoor mentioned, I would humbly like to differ with Khairul here, regional cooperation in energy, keeping in mind the SDG goals is very, very important here. We all know that in the Nepal-Bhutan basin, there is tremendous potential for hydro-based energy, that's clean energy. What are the plans of the government? I know some initiatives have already been done since the Honorable Prime Minister was in Bhutan. Some understandings have been signed. But I think we should emphasize more on this and try to get the best out of this initiative. That's number two. And number three is my comment would be about policy. I think in terms of policy, we need to be very much clear. Because still the fact is that now natural gas has become very expensive and we are not giving new connections. But the existing connections that are there for industries, even if the industry does not use natural gas, they are still being charged a minimum charge of 12 lakh taka per month. I think that really hurts the competitiveness of especially textile sector. I would request the government to look into it. Thank you very much. Those are all the comments that I had.
Now our next discussion would be Mr. Abrar Anwar, Chief Executive Officer, Standard Chartered Bank.
Thank you, sir. No, basically I think Energy Security 2030, it transpires with all the plans, capital generation and deployment in the effective manner would be of key importance to ensure that a country remains in terms of credit rating and all, positively exposed, as well as able to mobilize capital to ensure that in the least cost deployment is possible. So far we have seen a lot of G2G projects and limited access to export credit agency and bilateral financing. Bangladesh is still not present in the global capital market. I think some initiatives are underway by the government. There are a lot of capital out there. We just need to ensure that we are well positioned to capitalize on that. So looking at it, I think almost $40 to $50 billion would be required, if not more. I think in that area there are some synchronized policy support from central bank and also perspective the government would be required to ensure that we are able to mobilize international capital at the most efficient way. Because local capital market and banking sector is not capable of supporting so much of investment. So we need to be externally focused, maybe starting with some quasi-sovereign bonds or power bond or energy bond. This is on the table, so I would urge Honorable Advisor to consider these options in the future.
Thank you, Abrar. Our next discussion would be Ms. Sitzel Blekken, Ambassador, Norwegian Embassy.
Thank you. First, I would like to thank you, the Chamber, for organizing this very important conference. Energy security is something of importance for all of us and for the future development. I think we have had a very good discussion here today about the challenges, but also on the opportunities. There are a number of areas where I believe Bangladesh has huge opportunities, but I also like to encourage you to look more into the renewable energy. This is part of the global challenges. The global climate change, which affects Bangladesh so much, is also something that every country will need to take their responsibility. So every country will need to look into also possibilities for increasing the renewable energy in the energy mix, as well as looking into what was highlighted here as one of the big opportunities, energy efficiency. There is so much that is being wasted of the energy, and to improve that would bring out a big future. Then I'd like to have a small comment to the last gentleman as well about the foreign investments and foreign capital. I think that's an area, energy is an area where there are a number of foreign companies that would be interested, including Norwegians. What is needed is good regulations and predictable regulations and good negotiations on price, because these are very costly investments and it's needed to know what would be possible returns as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Our next discussion would be Mr. Architect Mohammad Alamgir Jalil, President, Bangladesh Malaysia Chamber of Commerce and Industry. We'll now proceed to the next discussion. Dr. Mohammad Shafiqul Islam, Chairman, Associate Professor, Department of Nuclear Engineering, University of Dhaka.
Thank you, moderator. I've been doing research on energy crisis in Bangladesh. So I have found a lot of points about the reasons of energy crisis and how to solve the energy crisis. So basically, since time will not allow me to talk about these issues in detail, what I'd like to say, the reasons for energy crisis, actually, I do agree with the seminar speaker, Professor Tamim, onshore and offshore energy and gas explorations, local and imported coal, supply problems, and then governance. What is the problem of governance? As you see, say there are 6 distribution companies in the country. If you divide 1 bigger of land in many parts, what will be the situation? Management situation, resource situations, and many problems will be there. I think we should rethink about the reformation policy about the distribution or transmissions. And one more thing is that there is many problems about the policy, regulation and implementations. For example, there is no distribution policy between urban and rural areas. There is no course, standards and other issues for distributions and transmissions. And also the severe problem, what is discussed today's seminar, that education, research and training activities. Professor Tamim has mentioned that there is a serious problem of human resources, definitely. And he also has mentioned about that 1% saving of energy by using efficient equipment will save 20% of power generation. But this is the technical issue point of view. But prior to that, we have to think about that, how to generate, how to develop energy conscious people. That is very important, because of without the right people, we cannot save a lot of energy. Whatever we introduce, the right equipment. I think we need to develop the skilled human resources, especially energy engineering, energy science and engineering. I think mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, actually that's the last word I'd like to say, Center, and chemical engineers will not be sufficient to take care of the energy and power sector. There should be the particular energy science and engineering discipline who will teach the energy conservation, energy planning, energy efficiency, energy culture, energy law, energy project management, and all these things.
Thank you very much.
I'm definitely sure that the electrical department, chemical department, mechanical department, they don't teach about those things. This is the very important issue. So I like to urge all to think about all the research institute and public universities to introduce this kind of. Thank you very much. Thank you for giving the opportunity. Thank you.
Controlling time. So our next discussion, Mr. Dipal C. Barua, President Bangladesh Renewable Energy Association. Mr. Barua, again, 2 minutes.
Thank you. I think I will be straight to the point. One is the Honorable Excellency mentioned from Norway. I believe Bangladesh has a chance for renewable energy. We have around 5 million solar home system, basically around 15% people getting electricity from the solar energy. I believe Bangladesh has a good chance, and Professor Tamim mentioned that they have a limited resources of land is okay, but I think there are rooftop is very potential. I believe from one item, say solar irrigation, 10,000 megawatt we can produce to replace 1.3 million diesel pump if we replace it, and already it call financing 700 already is there. I believe Bangladesh, we are not going to debate that renewable energy is not feasible in Bangladesh, but it should be focused on renewable energy. From fossil fuel to renewable energy is very important. I believe at least 30,000 megawatt we can produce from the renewable energy in Bangladesh. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Barua. Next discussion, Mr. M.S. Siddiqui, again reminding you about 2 minutes.
Thank you. Professor Talib has mentioned about the good news. He has given good news that the liquid fossil fuel price will be more or less stable. But he didn't discuss about the price of coal in global market. I want to mention here that three giant coal users, the America, India and China, have going to started reducing use of coal. India has a 10 years plan to reduce the use of coal up to 47% of the total energy production. And the China has declared that clean sky policy. So in near future, you will find that the price demand of coal will go down, and also gradually the price naturally will go down. And we are going to increase our use of coal, so there will be a very lucrative market of coal in Bangladesh. Bangladesh will be a very good market. But I presume the price will go down. Not only that, Professor Tanim hoped that BAPEXO will go global for joint venture in other countries to bring some energy fuel in our country. But I can tell you, there are many countries, many mine in Indonesia, India, Australia or South Africa, they will sell out their coal mine. Bangladesh can go and buy some coal mine in these countries in near future, within 15 to 20 years. And did Professor Tarim didn't mention about the, didn't discuss about the nuclear power plant. I don't know why. And he didn't discuss about the environment issue also. But I think it should be discussed all together. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Our next discussion is Mr. Irshad Hussain, CEO, Citibank Capital.
Thank you. What I would like to mention is we're actually working with some of the IPP, solar IPP projects. And what we see is, you know, the bankability of the solar solar PPA, because conventional IPPs, they have the capacity payment built into the agreement, whereas the solar IPP, it's mostly it has an energy charge, so that is a barrier to the bankability of the PPA itself. The other thing is we also want to understand where the government is heading to issuance of a green bond or an infrastructure bond, which like India has with a tax exemption structure. And the other things for the, especially like the government has a 10% of total installed capacity for renewables. And I also want to know, has the government done anything to basically secure that for solar IPP evacuation, that has the grid, is it like capable of handling it? So that is my take. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Our next discussion would be Mr. Salim Akhtar Khan, the Director DCCI and Chairman Asset Development Holdings Limited.
Thank you, sir. My question to Dr. Tamim and also to Dr. Hassan Mansoor is regarding their forecasting about the consumption side. They have been concentrating mostly on the supply side forecasting and availabilities and risks. I represent the housing sector where just 15 years ago we were building housing units having a requirement of approximately 3 kilowatt per family of 5 or 6 persons. That is just 0.5 kilowatt per person. Now we are building and constructing multi-storied units all over Bangladesh, in most of the district towns and including Dhaka, having the provision for almost 20 kilowatt per person. 12 kilowatt is for the household, around 7 to 12 kilowatt is for the household, and the rest is for provisions for lift. Whether you use it or not, we are putting in lifts in all buildings from 8 stories to 14 stories and up. That means per person it's, and the household size is also reduced. It has come down to 4 to 5 persons. So that is roughly 4 to 5 kilowatt per person. So just 15 years ago it was 0.5 kilowatt per person, and now it is 5 to 6 kilowatt per person. And this is likely to go up. So, and the housing sector will ultimately always, the households will always represent the ultimate consumption class in Bangladesh. So whether these aspects have been factored in into the forecasting for the next only 12 years, we are talking about 2030, this is 12 years from now, which is not a very big span of time. Thank you.
So our next presenter would be Mr. Nissan Maksud Khan, Managing Director, Max Group.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum and good afternoon. I'd like to come to the point. Actually, our generation, as you have seen, that it is around 15,000 megawatt, but we are getting 10,000 megawatt. So there is a gap. I think the efficiency level of the existing power plant need to be improved rather than we going to the new power plants. The focus should be given. Already, Khairul Bhai have talked about transmission and distribution line. That's very, very important. If the evacuation is not done, so we cannot utilize the electricity what we are generating. We have studied that during the when there is a good number of production of power, sometimes the demand is not there. Only in the main capital cities the demand is needed, but in the rural and other areas the demand is much less. So we have to plan accordingly how we do the generation and all. Just keep on generation will not give us the serve the purpose. Secondly, I'm working on renewable energy. And I'd like to highlight that we should focus on rooftop solar because we have shortage of land and evacuation also a issue for the large megawatt scale power plant. So I humbly request the Honorable Advisor to consider feed-in tariff that has been under discussion for a long time. I think we should come up with a favorable tariff so that we can really focus on rooftop solar project. Thank you very much.
Our next discussion to be Mr. Bashirullah Bhuiya, Managing Director, Shadow International Limited.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much. I have only some comments. We know that the power consumption increased geometrically against limited power productions by the BPDP and IPP. We have only the two primary fuel, gas and coal in on user by the BPDP in Bolopukuri at 250 megawatt existing power plant, and next 250 megawatt will coming next year. But we know that every power plant having the 20 years planning for production planning, but we are using our power plant more than 20 years and efficiency going down day by day. In that case, we can modernize our existing power plant to for efficiently use our gas, because gas is now scarcity is going day by day. On the other hand, we can use the renewable energy in the giving the intensive for the rooftop and the industrial rooftop for solar power generations. Thank you, moderators.
Thank you. I would now invite Mr. S. M. Farmanul Islam. Again, one. Please try to limit it within 1 and 2 minutes.
Thank you, sir. Assalamu alaikum. I have two small points here to mention. One is that I believe availability or lack of energy resources is not the major hindrance. Look at Japan, look at Korea. More than 95% of their resources are imported, but they are very good in energy management and they are industrialized country. Again, look at Nigeria, 13th producing country in the world, but look at their situation. Very poor. So it is more like governance and having proper regulatory regime and making the sector market based. That is more important. We have to look at that. And again, about the government's vision of achieving 20,000 megawatt by 2020, you need to add at least around 10,000 megawatt. So $10 billion will be needed to be invested for production only, let alone transmission, distribution, and other stuff. Where the money is coming from? So we have more than 100 banks and financial institutions locally. How to capacitate them? There is an issue. People say that we don't have the capacity, but do we really give them an opportunity to support? We are going for G2G, we are going for development partners, we are going for so many, such and such. I think local institutions can be given a chance to participate in big deals. And then the third is, when you talk about India, we always talk about good things. But how many of us aware that Indian power market is at boiling point? Their surplus, they have to sell power, export power, because their utilities cannot pay capacity payment. So have to look at that. Unless you can rationalize the tariff and create a demand for that, even investing a lot in the power sector can be a big hindrance, not only for the government, but also for the banks and financial institutions. Thank you.
Okay, our next discussion, we have two more only. Mr. Al Mudabbir bin Anam from ZIZ.
Thank you, moderator. And thank you, Tamim sir, for the very informative presentation. I'd like to focus few areas, and especially on the energy efficiency. You have rightly mentioned that which is a significant contribution to the energy security. We have the energy efficiency master plan, but we may still look into more into the supply side energy efficiency improvement as well, not only demand side. Energy conservation, that also a very pivotal role in this area, which is a little bit, we feel, neglected. That could be highlighted more. In terms of renewable energy, the SREDA and World Bank assessment of 3,300 megawatt, I feel this is a bit conservative, but still, that is 10% of our anticipated generation plan by 2030. If we can get the right business model, for example, for the interventions for the rooftop solar, as well as we can mitigate the grid integration challenges, we can look into more renewable energy electricity generation. Regional energy cooperation in terms of regional hydro, there are huge capacities. We see that government is already moving towards that, but this energy efficiency, conservation, renewable energy and regional hydro may have a good impact in terms of overall energy planning that you have rightly mentioned about the bottom-up planning on integrated resource planning. You have also mentioned rightly, sir, about human resource development. We may more look into the human resource planning and how that can be sustainable towards a cohesive organizational development. And finally, the involvement of private sector in more cohesive way in policy planning, business model, and implementation of our energy strategy.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Anna.
Very good GDP growth.
Our next discussant, again, these are only 1 minute. We are running really short of time. Mr. M.S. Shakil Chaudhary, Center for NIB.
ধন্যবাদ। আমি খুব সংক্ষেপে আমাদের সরকার, বিশেষ করে উপদেষ্টা মহোদয় এবং চেয়ারম্যান স্ট্যান্ডিং কমিটি, তাদের কাছে আমার একটা আবদার আছে। সেটা হলো যে আজকে বাংলাদেশে আমরা যে কথাগুলো বলছি যে আমাদের গ্যাস নেই, একটু আগে আলোচনা এসেছিল যে এর আগে গ্যাসের উপরে ভাসছিলাম, এই বক্তব্যগুলো আসছে কোত্থেকে? যে এক্সপার্টসরা এগুলো তৈরি করে দিচ্ছেন, রিয়েলি দে আর বেসড অন রিয়েলিটি? আমি এই জন্যই বলবো যে প্রধানমন্ত্রী বা সরকার যখন একটা বক্তব্য উপস্থাপন করছেন, তথ্য ভাণ্ডারগুলো সরবরাহ করছেন এক্সপার্টসরা, এই যে দিকদর্শনহীন যদি কথাবার্তা হয় তাহলে এগুলোর উপর ভিত্তি করবো কীভাবে? সেই জন্য পূর্ব পশ্চিম না করে দেশজ মেধাভিত্তিক যে সম্পদগুলো আছে সেগুলোকে যদি আমরা ব্যবহার করবার একটা পরিকল্পনা নিতে পারি। আমাদের আজকে উপদেষ্টা মহোদয় এবং আমি চেয়ারম্যান দুজনকে ব্যক্তিগতভাবে চিনি, আপনারা নিজেদের আলোয় আলোকিত, কিন্তু অনেকেই আছেন পরের আলোয় আলোকিত, তারাই কিছু সব কিছু পরিকল্পনা করছেন। আমাদের দেশের যে মেধাবী লোকজন আছেন তাদেরকে এই দিকদর্শন চিন্তা না করে কাজে লাগানোর জন্য রিয়েলিস্টিক যদি না হয়, এনার্জি সিকিউরিটি ইজ দি বেস লাইন অফ এন এ নেশন, এটাকেই যদি আমরা ফেব্রিকেটেড করি, ইচ্ছা মাফিক ফরমাইশ মাফিক যদি প্রস্তুত করি, তথ্য ভাণ্ডারগুলো সঠিক না থাকে, তাহলে ক্ষতিগ্রস্ত হওয়ার সম্ভাবনা জাতি হিসেবে। সেই জন্য আবদার করব, অনুরোধ করব আপনাদের কাছে, রাষ্ট্রীয় পরিকল্পনায় বাংলাদেশের দেশজ মেধাগুলোকে যেন কাজে লাগানো হয়। ধন্যবাদ।
Our last discussant, Mr. Nuher El Khan, Managing Director, Jules Power Limited.
Thank you. I'd just like to make a point on the PPA issue raised by Mr. Ashraf Hussain of Citibank Capital. We're currently executing a 28 megawatt peak solar IPP. We're happy to say that we've already opened our LC and executing the construction and should be online by 2018 February. To address the PPA issue, while it's true that there's no capacity payments, but it's quite a fair situation because you understand solar is largely reliant on sun. So it's not fair on the government to pay us when we're not available. However, there is a stipulation whereby when the vehicle is available for production, and if the off-taker does not buy our power, there's a liquidity damages imposed. So I hope that clarifies your issue on bankability of our PPA. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We have one more addition. This is really the final discussion. Mr. Mathieu Rahman, former chairman, president at DCCI.
Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to tell something. I have come, listened many objectives and demerits. One thing I have noticed, we do not know what is our system loss now. So 10, 15 years before, we used to know that our power system loss was 33%. Now what is the present system loss? How much we have saved or not? Another thing, we understand the huge gas available in Myanmar. Why not we think about setting up a power plant in Myanmar under joint venture G2G and buy the gas for our power for our own country? These two points I have to raise. Thank you very much.
Excuse me, I'm sorry that I have to be brutal with time allocation. So I'll have my 2 minutes now. Okay, so I'm slightly more gung-ho than Professor Tamim about renewable energy. When we started IDCO's program of solar home system, so everybody said 50,000 in 5 years, impossible. Now we have nearly 5 million solar home systems. Please understand that the globally solar energy dynamics is changing, and we need to recognize that. Elon Musk of Tesla has announced that he'll produce roof that will replace traditional roofs, and that it'll be almost zero cost or negative cost. So we really need to understand solar energy dynamics. Look at India. India said that they will produce 40 gigawatt of rooftop solar. So India is roughly 22 times Bangladesh. So if you divide that by 22, even this number, then we'll have about 2,500 megawatts of electricity from rooftop solar alone. The second thing that I would like to talk about, this is a story that was published in New York Times in 2011. Gautam Adani was awarded a power plant based on Indian coal. He decided to ditch Indian coal. So the problem of coal is basically logistical. Because if you have a mine mouth plant, that's not very difficult, but if you're import based, then there are huge logistical problems. So what Mr. Gautam Adani did, that he decided to import coal rather than depending on Indian coal. So then there's no port, so he decided to develop Mundra airport in Gujarat. Then he saw that the supply of coal is unreliable. So he went to buy mining interests in Australia and Indonesia. Then he thought that he found that transportation of coal is difficult. So he had this vessel named after our niece Vansi to carry this coal. So please understand that his original contract was to set up a coal power plant. So he really had to do all these things to meet this. So to bring the coal to his power plant, he also developed the railway lines. So we do not have entrepreneurs of that scale here, but I understand that. But you can separate out parts of it, that this energy related infrastructure, you can develop, somebody could develop a railway line that could connect, somebody could invest in shipping so that the coal could be brought, and so on and so forth. And also our banks, we have a representative for banks, and you could also look into the financing of this. Thank you very much, and thank you for giving me this opportunity to moderate this session.
Thank you very much, sir. It has been really interesting session. And now, ladies and gentlemen, may I call upon our special guest, Mr. Muhammad Tajul Islam, MP, Chairperson, Parliamentary Standing Committee on Power, Energy and Mineral Resources, to say a few words. Honourable special guest.
Honourable Chair, Mr. Abul Qasim Khan, President of the Dhaka Chamber, and Honourable Chief Guest, Mr. Taufiqi Elahi Chowdhury Bir Bikram, all other special guests, diplomats, experts, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, printed and electronic media, Assalamu Alaikum. Firstly, I express my heartiest thanks to Dhaka Chamber to organize such a discussion over opportunities and challenges of power and energy of Bangladesh of 2030. We, everybody, much more aware that Bangladesh was classified as a poor and hopeless country. From this status, our Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina dreamed to lift this country in the platform of the middle income country and developed country. To meet the demand of developed and mid income country, we are able to fix the challenges, especially our infrastructure, power, and transportation. So mitigate this problem, especially about the energy and power. A cross-sectional effort have been taken by the government. There is a lot of discussion already been held in here, and every day we are discussing in the media and anywhere else. But reality, we know everybody, especially the people we have gathered here, everybody know our status. We are very densely country. We have a very scarce of land. We have a very small opportunity of the mineral resources. And as because our property and our education level was not that much comparable with the European and other developed countries. So this is why our mood of development and the roadmap cannot be compared with other countries. We must have to consider our limitation. We must have to know about our drawbacks, what we have, from where we are trying to come up. In here, actually, there is some very interesting discussion have been held, especially if I go to the renewable energy. Yeah, renewable energy, globally, it is a very good slogan, not only slogan, many where it is giving the very good output. But we must have to consider Bangladesh. We are very land hungry country. We do not have the much land. And some days before, in one discussion, I have came to know that one person have pointed out that in India, it is 3 rupees solar electricity price. But in Bangladesh, we are about 17 taka. So how could we care why this kinds of a cost is exaggerated? But technical people must, I definitely know, those who are participating in the discussion, in Europe you say, if we go to Germany, in the one day I have seen that it is 11 o'clock at night Bangladesh, but still the sunset is there, sun is there. So the solar you can extract from there, I think about 11 hours. And according to the survey report, India you can extract the solar for 8 hours about, but Bangladesh is less than 4 hours. And in India, vast land is vacant. You can install solar panel for electricity. This land is no price, but Bangladesh land price is very high. So in such a context, I think we should think over very carefully about the renewable energy opportunity. Yes, about the home system, we are claiming, not only claiming, that Bangladesh is a number one in the world. 4.5 million home system we have installed, and we have proven what, if any opportunity we have, we definitely able to extract this opportunity. About the coal, we must be practical. India, about 200,000 megawatt are producing from the coal resources, coal power. And China is more than 600,000 megawatt coal are generating energy, power is producing from the source of the coal. So, but we are only 200 megawatt are producing. But every concern is expressing about Bangladesh when we are moving for the energy solution about the by the coal. So we do not have the alternative. We do not have that much enough energy. One question has been raised here. Somebody have shown some of the fictitious news that Bangladesh is floating on the gas. But finally we find that we do not have the gas. This was all this motivatory, actually, news was broadcasted. So I think nowadays we should convinced about it. About the Rampal issue, you see, Sundarban, World Heritage Site listed by the Sheikh Hasina. She herself have initiated. And in the 1997, when she was the Prime Minister first time, she fought in the international community to incorporate Sundarban as a World Heritage Site. But now, if I like to say, the Sheikh Hasina have taken an assignment to destroy the Sundarban. So I think, is it messable with the actually her target and the goal and the activities? So I think we should be practical. Rampal was, I think, must have already been done, so I do not like to point out. But here it is one of the things that I myself have visited. Our honorable advisor is here. He is a very rare person in Bangladesh. He have a lot of expertise about the energy, and he worked as a energy secretary, and last two times he is working as the advisor and serving very seriously in dynamic approach is giving for the energy solution in Bangladesh. I think he will speak a lot of things, the questions those which have already been arising. My one thing is that we have an expectation to reach us in the status of a developed country. So we will talk, we can criticize, we can contest, but I appreciate it. But it should be practical. Few days back, one alternative proposal have been submitted by some group of people about the energy. So I myself got a little chance to go through this proposal. I find that there is actually is not really is dependent on the practical situation of energy of Bangladesh. We can tell many things, we can write something else, but implementation is not that much easy. So I think we everybody knows it, that it is not at all possible. It could be, it cannot be alternative. Okay, I express my thanks, those who have produced these kinds of a paper, they at least they have given their lot of effort and homework they did, and through that they have produced something else. But it could be a supplementary proposal, but it cannot be alternative. So whenever we will deliver, or we will criticize, or we will pay some sorts of the comments, if it is goes against the our main ambition or goal, then it is a, I think, problem. So I think everybody is very much concerned about our energy solution. But I'm going to conclude my speech like this way, that actually one person have pointed out very nicely that actually price is not the main factor. Competitiveness is the main factor. It has been proved by South Korea. Because they are the country of zero resource of the mineral of energy. But on the depending on the imported energy, they have able to scale up their country in the platform of the developed country. So, and the South, about the Nigeria, you see, once we are in an economic discussion, it was pointing out that many times, the demographic dividend of South Nigeria and South Korea was same in one period. But Nigeria failed to extract the demographic opportunity, but South Korea able to use their opportunity because of they are the developed country. So I think it is not the big matter what how much the price will be. Definitely imported price will be high because our natural resources we are not calculating calculating the international price. We are not at all giving the price. We are just expenditures we are calculating and selling to our market for boosting our economy. So, but I believe the experts are, if give their inclusive effort about the energy solution and in the master plan of power, which have been produced by JICA, there is a lot of directive is there. I believe I am not a frustrated. We can actually, I think we can solve and we can reach to the goal of our developed country. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I request our chief guest, Dr. Taufiq-e-Ilahi Bir Bikram, Honorable Advisor to the Prime Minister on Power, Energy and Mineral Resources Affairs, to deliver his speech. Honorable Chief Guest.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Khan, for arranging this important seminar this morning, weekend though. And thank you, Fazil, for being a very ruthless moderator, speak about what you can achieve efficiently. So efficiency is a generic term, you know. Time efficiency, energy efficiency. Now let me, there have been a lot of interesting and important discussions. But let me, because you are basically a business chamber, let me say how I look at your problems or how government looks at your problems and how we try solving the problem. It's more of an algorithm rather than taking a fixed view and then working on that path. So we first tried to improve, as you know, generation capacity. Kachinibo. Capacity, and we have largely been able to do so. But then generating electricity is not good enough. I'll come down to other issues. We have to take them to the customers, provide them quality electricity, reliable electricity, uninterrupted electricity. That job is yet to be done. So I think if you ask me, priority as I look forward, that whatever capacity we have developed, we must have a transmission network, a reliable transmission network, a reliable distribution network, which will ensure that the customers get reliable electricity, quality. If I had more time, I would say how we are working. in terms of nitty-gritties, from finance to projects to implementation. I could go down to each of them, but if you take my words for granted, you know, I can assure you another 2 years' time, all these efforts will be in place and function. Somebody raised the question about system loss. We know at once upon a time used to be around 30%. We are close to, we plan to go single digit, inshallah, by next year. We are around 10% now. So I think that's been a huge improvement on the energy loss, pilferage, whatever we say. Now, if I look beyond, let's say next year, this will be important for those who have industries, but those who are trying to planning new industries, they will look for longer time frame. But we have to leave tomorrow to plan for day after tomorrow. So next year, there has been, you know, gas shortage all these years. Next year, inshallah, we'll be able to increase gas supply by 50%. It's not 500, we'll have 500 and another 500, 1,000 MMCFD of gas flowing into the system. So that would significantly ameliorate the gas shortage in quantitative terms. Next, the question comes, what would be the pricing? People have gone into discussions about blending and, you know, whatever international price and, you know, that. I don't get into those details, but whatever the international price, we'll have to buy at that price. There's been an understanding there'll be no taxes on this end. But even then, we'll have to blend and sell. Our secretary has been calling some of you, I don't know whether you have met him, to share with you the likely price regime and what you can afford, and try to kind of understand your cash flow system. Our government has always been ready to support industries. Our Prime Minister's single motto is to develop the country. Our focus is on developing the country. And so, if there are financial support that needs to be built into the pricing system for you all to, you know, improve your efficiency, to absorb this cost increase, we'll certainly talk about it. But I can assure you, inshallah, next year we'll have, first half of next year we'll have 500 MMCFD, and following that, the second half we'll have another 500 MMCFD of gas, which will almost raise about 40% gas supply into the system. Now next, because it's tied up with this, you know, we are setting up special economic zone. And the question came, how do you want to support the special economic zone? There are a couple of alternatives available to you. Let's say there are private sectors who are setting up economic zone. We would like to provide quality electricity. We have talked about individually how that can be ensured to the special economic zone. And I request all of you, those who are either have proposed special economic zone or those who plan to establish special economic zone, to come and discuss with us as to how we can ensure quality electricity to you. But here I have a solution which I would like you, encourage you to look into. You know, if you have even a simple cycle power plant, even it may be even a HFO run power plant, and if you can co-generate and tri-generate that system, then your energy efficiency will go up about 80 to 90%. Now, how you can do that? If you plan your special economic zone in such a way that there are people who will utilize heat, and then maybe some who will utilize heat for freezing, then this simple, you know, reciprocating engine whose electricity efficiency may be 40%, but then you take the waste heat. I'm going into little details because you are all serious people, so I want you to. If you take the waste heat, run some boilers, and then when the temperature goes down, take it for refrigeration, then you raise your energy efficiency by 80% or even more. That means you will be able to absorb much higher cost also. Or if the cost is low, then you enhance your margin. So I am proposing that some of those who are setting up special economic zone, or some of you can join hands with them and propose. But it will require the special economic zone to plan the investment in that way. Encourage some who will use waste heat, encourage some who will take lower temperature and go for refrigeration. It will need a planning of the customers also. This I am saying because, you know, it, world is a very competitive place. There is no free lunch. So creativity is our strength. And because we are a late starter, we can create, innovate, and be ahead of others. So this is one I request you very seriously consider, because time is running out. And if you can, if you come and say we want to set up an IPP for 50 megawatt based on diesel or based on LNG, if you want, and that you are going to do this cogeneration and trigeneration, I can assure you we will give you that. But please, you know, you are all young entrepreneurs. You have to be creative. Like Fazul mentioned about Adani's case. I really request you to sometime, if you have the, get some time to go and visit Paira. You know, it's bolder than Adani's dream. If you go and see that place. Have you, if you had seen that place before, you know, miles after miles, there's nothing. Distant sea. And that place was chosen for a power plant of 1320 megawatt. And it's coming up now. It's unbelievable. The coal for importing coal, the system is being put in place. These guys have gone and looked around to try to buy mines, which are also being discussed, so that we source our coal in a mine, if not 100%. And then evacuation system is being worked out. It's like having something in the moon, I tell you. I was so impressed. I couldn't believe that so much can be done. So yes, I think Kashem is there. The other day, the contract was signed, single largest contract in Bangladesh for Madrabari power plant, $2.5 billion. A port is coming up. We don't need this port for Paira, you know. Paira is far away. This Madrabari will help, you know, the hub, power hub that we are creating. There will be a deep sea port there. Work is on progress. There will be 1200 megawatt power plant there. And you know, a $2.5 billion single contract, Bangladesh, I guess it must be the largest single contract. So it's also, you know, the Rampal power project is also coming online. But let me tell you one thing, you know, many of you were raised the question, but I don't know, you don't, every one of you is not there in every meeting. We have spent a lot of time looking into the scientific aspect of mining coal in the north. We've gone deep into the science of it. Somebody mentioned that you are not serious. You know, you don't know how much of spine we have spent, how much of depth we have gone into. But before I explain that, let me tell you, many of us don't know that how small a country Bangladesh is and how big a country it is. Take a quarter of France. You know, France, take a quarter of France. Put in all the French population in that place. Put in all the German population in this place. Put in all the Danish population in this place. Put all the Norwegian population in this place. That is Bangladesh. Such a small space. You must remember that. You know, we keep on forgetting. It's such a small country with a large population. But inshallah, we've done extremely well. North Bengal is very rich in agriculture. There is a large aquifer that runs underneath the coal mine. If you want to mine that place, you are going to disturb that coal aquifer that runs from Himalayas down to Bay of Bengal. And that we have done some modeling also. Not even in around Borupukia mine. The Institute of Water Modeling had done it for us. We did some drilling also to see how much of the aquifer will be disturbed. And it's much too risky. North Bengal, even if this few underground mine, local aquifer has gone become conical. In a large place, if you do, you don't know. There are some technologies which ring fence the mine. So the mine is ring fenced and then you dry it. But these are more experimental. So Bangladesh, in its own way, you know, we have been able to raise food. When the population doubled, our food production has gone 3 times. So you should, there is a balance with which we have to. Somebody said that it will never be utilized again. There is no romance about it. You know, if you can go, proceed, go ahead. If someday everything is abandoned and renewable energy takes the place, so be it. So, but while we look at this, you know, if I then take a step forward, 3 years down the road, you know, coal-based power plants that take very long. 7 years, 6 years, minimum time. Exploration, oil and gas exploration in deep sea, if you find something today, you can expect 10 years that it will flow. So while you plan those things, you have to live those 10 years. We have already given to Dayu and POSCO 2 blocks. Because of the low oil price, those who are interested in the, our incentive is comparable with any other country's incentive for oil and gas exploration in the deep sea. But then, you know, countries have expressed that at this price, they cannot. Statoil was here. I spent hours with them. I said, what do you want? We'll give you that. But come and, you know, Statoil is very famous and a very dependable company. We're ready to write a blank check. But then they changed their mind. So I can't force an investor, but the point is, at this price, deep sea oil and gas exploration is not very viable for investors, unless they find some new technology or things which will make difference in cost. So we cannot rely on that and stop our, we have to, hoping that they will come, hoping that things will change, we have to take other measures as well. Because I can't tell you that, you know, please come 5 years later and if things happen, you go and set up industry. We have to make sure, even through these challenges, we find pathways to go ahead. So, some of, as you have heard, we are trying to set up some 5-year based IPPs based on liquid fuel. This is because that gap, next to three, four, 5 years, we have to fill it in. It's no use arguing. And we want to be ahead of the curve. If the demand is X, we want to have X plus delta something and be able to transmit, distribute that. So we have seen that in another 3-4 years before these large coal-fired power plants, you know, Payra may be coming, you know, first in 2019. There is a slippage, you know, in power. Mr. Kasem is there. The power engineer, 6 months slippage is nothing for them. Oh, I think that 6 months, a year. So we have to fill in that blank. And the only way we can do is to have some liquid fuel-based power plants. Those who said about increasing efficiency of existing power plants, already doing that. We are retrofitting some or replacing some of these industries. But we can't let a power demand be unsatisfied. And the industries that are coming up, the demand that's being, you know, expected to generate, housing and others, you know, per capita, not only connection, we are hoping to, inshallah, have the country connected by next year, most of the countries. But that is connectivity. But then, you know, they start consuming electricity, we provide reliable electricity, per capita income goes up, per capita electricity consumption goes up. It's a cycle. And that cycle we have to meet with specific actions on ground. I can't sell a plan. We have to sell electricity. In the same way, with respect to primary energy, as I said, we have, inshallah, next year, 1,000 MMCFD, and then we have plans to set up land-based LNG and maybe another 1 or 2 FSRU, hoping that about 4,000 MMCFD we have. If this can be done, the FSRU can be done faster. So
about 4,000 MMCFD of gas we have in mine next few years. With that gas, we'll be able to also provide, but I'm sure those who have captive power plants and all, they must have cogeneration, trigeneration, or else they can't afford this price. And we have talked in earlier meetings also. Titas is also providing some energy audit, but I think you are now smart enough to have energy audit done and start retrofitting your industries. The payback period I've seen maybe a year, 9 months. So I would like to, particularly the younger ones, I see many who have been, you know, friends for a long time. They might be tired, but their children must have come and taken the reins. So please ask them to closely go and find out how energy efficiency can be. In a longer haul, you know, as I said, coal will be a major plank. And the gentleman didn't mention nuclear energy. Also, you know, there is the research going on modular nuclear energy, 100, 200 megawatt plug and play. Some of them have already applied for license in the United States, and Bill Gates has invested heavily in this modular nuclear power plant. We are keeping track of that, whether if it is available, we would like to access that. But Rupur is coming in any case as a bigger nuclear power plant. Regional connectivity we are pursuing. We have been able to, will be soon, it will go up about 1100 megawatt. We are also considering quite a GMR, a company, we are signing MOU for bringing electricity from Nepal. From Bhutan also, it's in good progress. GMR is an IPP, we are buying it from them. Someone mentioned about Myanmar, and at least I can feel proud that at least I thought of it 5 years back. I myself traveled to Myanmar and talked to their authorities, saying that, look, there may be a difference between neighbors, but that should not hold us cooperative. And I think I was about to convince them that your gas in Raikabai, Sitwa plant, where they had some excess. I said, you want to generate electricity. We have power plants sitting idle in Chittagong. You provide us this gas, we provide you the electricity. And the Rakhine state is, there is a mountain going north-south. So it will be very tough for them to bring electricity there. So this was before the election. And they bought in the idea. I said, look, if you hit bigger reserves, then you have to look for customers. And in the west side, you have customers. So they had decided to send a team. But then the election came, and then the Rohingya issue came again. But our ambassador is working very hard to see. And I'm hopeful, inshallah, that we'll be able to have gas and electricity connectivity with Myanmar. And other trade should also flourish. And there are private sector here, why don't you go and you try to work as a facilitator on these ideas. At times, government to government ideas are tough to, bring on a negotiating table. So you can do some behind the work scene and earn some money too. I'm sure there are ways you find out to earn some money. So I would request you to do that. Let me try to see whether in the meantime I have covered some. One other point, time only will say whether we are smart or he's smart. But Adani is setting up a 1200 megawatt power plant in Jharkhand. And there will be a dedicated line to Bangladesh. And we'll buy that electricity. We have negotiated the price also. I think it's about 6 taka, if I'm not mistaken. So the power plant will be in Jharkhand slightly. And they will produce electricity, and the dedicated transmission line will come to Bangladesh, and we buy the electricity. About LNG price, Kasim was saying, it is that we are going to import that. So it will depend on the import price. We have a MOU with Qatar, so we'll buy some, we have finished negotiation, we'll buy some of the gas, LNG from Qatar, but we'll keep some option open to go and buy from spot market on a short term. My guess is, you know, $7-$8 LNG, but once you blend it, you know, depending on whether it's 1,000 mmCFD or 500 mmCFD, you can work it out. But as I said, if you take energy efficiency measures, you can cut down your energy consumption. And we can work together. If there is a really harsh on some industries or some starting point, we can work together to make it at least workable for you for a year or so. So, as I said, Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, you know, she has always come up with practical solutions, but sometimes very bold decisions. So, whether it is a practical solution or a bold decision about future, she will not be short in any of those things. You just have to let us know. I mean, the biggest example is that Hassan Mansour worked in one of those multilateral Bretton Woods institutions. World Bank tried to cut us down. What they did as a big service. We are off their hook. We are on their own, on our own. And now coming to the question raised by Arbab and all, and you might know, we are already working on $1 billion bond issue by PDB, so that PDB can go out and access, start accessing international market. So if we need to speed up, if we succeed in a $1 billion bond, then we can issue more bonds. You know, and you are right, we are talking about $50 billion maybe investment. So it's a large amount of money you are talking about. Also, we are planning to, we are working to sell local bond by one of our power companies, maybe about 600 crore to 800 crore, which will come into local market, so that we also give some depth to the capital market in Bangladesh, and you know, get the companies also more involved. And this would also help increase the efficiency and human capital that we are talking about. Because if I have to go to the market, my balance sheet has to be good enough. People must be able to access my balance sheet. My, you know, everything has to be transparent. So this is also in another way of upgrading the capacity. Also, we are also signing a contract with one of the leading consulting firm, BCG, for helping us in all our companies, public sector companies, to raise capacity in terms of, you know, company operation, financial management, manpower management, and start looking at the power plant as a business operation rather than a technical operation. So we are also working on that. So I hope, you know, I've talked about next year, I've talked about 3, 4, 5 years. And then if you go beyond that, 7, 8 years, then these coal-fired power plants start coming in. As we move along, 2030, we're talking about at least 35,000 megawatt of electricity. You know, if the consumption goes up, you know, the way retail customers are doing, then it may even go up further. But while we do this, we'll try to create a balance between supply and demand by what is called smart grid. So we'll, in the meantime, move ahead with smart grid. Smart grid means, you know, it will help the customer to know how he is spending his electricity, whether they're efficient, inefficient. And it will also help the generator to allocate electricity. That look, you know, time is tough. You will get X amount of electricity so that you can only run maybe one air conditioner in your house. If you do more than that, your line will be slapped, not the whole system. So we are moving in that direction of smart grid. If you ask me, even longer hold, then we have established two more institutions to do that. One is Sustainable and Renewable Development Authority, we call SREDA, which is dedicating to see how much energy efficiency, renewable energy, energy conservation, green codes, all those areas where there is a lot of scope for work, you know. I hope sometime Rehab would take some interest and try to generate a green code for buildings. We have had done some work by the Engineering University Buet on this, but I would request Rehab to take more interest to see how energy efficient building can be developed, how rainwater harvesting can be done, because water is going to be another challenge. So if you do rainwater harvesting, which we are, the Prime Minister ordered all the public buildings to have rainwater harvesting. So if you start working on energy efficient building, rainwater harvesting, and solar rooftop, then combining this, you can have a real estate building which can be a model for other countries. You know, don't think that we have to look always at the West to for best practice. You know, it is our turn to also show some best practices. Like, you know, the solar home system, Faizul was involved, it's an example globally. So we have to have that confidence in ourselves. And the next instrument that we have put in place is Bangladesh Energy and Power Research Council. Because I think if you're talking of 2030, I think there are a lot of research that is going to make huge difference in 2030. I don't know them, but I can bet on that. And so we should try to mobilize resources in Bangladesh and abroad, Bangladeshis working abroad, to find areas where we can put our small research money. We have already started working on that. I have gone myself to get the American Bangladeshi, non-resident Bangladeshi in the United States to come on board. We're trying in other places also. The Energy and Research Council, we want to encourage our universities to undertake research, our even individuals, companies to undertake research. Research, and we want to see research in a very different way. It's not the traditional R&D that you talk about. That is why the mission of Energy and Power Research Council is I square E, innovation, incubation, entrepreneurship. We don't want to look at research, we want to innovate things. And then we have to incubate that thing, those which will be successful. And then we have to have entrepreneurs to take them, commercialize them. So I would also request private sector to start looking. You know, there can be innovation, small innovation everywhere. We are going to ask our engineers who are working in power stations, in transmission companies, distribution companies, to look at their own workplace and suggest innovation, improvement. And we can also invest in some basic areas where I think a breakthrough, if a breakthrough comes, it will be a huge thing. For example, I have, in my small way, I have encouraged people, and I'm also going to BCSIR and other places, to have a solar cooker. If the women of Bangladesh in rural areas could affordably cook with solar energy, then you have solved a huge problem. But this, nobody will do this research, because the industrial revolution that took place in the West, it took place when this need wasn't there. You know, they could go and cut woods, you know, the greenhouse gas and these issues are not there. And their colonies to go and exploit. We have, as I said, a very small country. So if there is a breakthrough in this way, it can make a huge difference. So I've been pushing our scientists. I've been to BCSIR a couple of times. Then Mr. Rezwan is also trying. I said, if JFK, John F. Kennedy said, let's go to the moon, there was no program. And the moon program was conceived after the statement was made. So I think if we can, in some areas, my sixth sense says there may be something in there, then you know we can make a big difference for us and for countries of, let's say, Africa and other places with a lot of sunshine. And last but not the least, those
you also must start thinking. If you have 2030 in mind, then there may be, you know, global connectivity. If there is global connectivity, and I was talking to one of the scientists, a north-south, east-west grid, then you could bring, theoretically speaking, the sun never sets in the world. It's the what our world that goes around, and we have been teaching our kids wrong thing. The sun sets, the sun never sets. So if you have a global grid connectivity, north, south, east, west, then you can have, you know, renewable energy, sunlight available for all, 24/7 electricity, 24/7. I've been talking, you know, for the last few years, but nobody really paid any attention. But I was very surprised to see that the Chinese company, they have already taken that initiative. They call it Global Connectivity Initiative or something. And they're setting up offices, I think. So, you know, whether this one or other one, you know, Mark Zuckerberg sent, you know, with this one of those satellites, the one that crashed, he had some small, you know, balloons or something with the, to go, so that whether it can be harnessed in the sky and the, you know, the energy could be sent back. So there must be ways, you know. And I am encouraging my youngsters to encourage others to find ways that, you know, which will help us not only help ourselves, but also help others globally. Humanity has seen apple falling for millenniums, but you have to wait for Newton to observe that. So there may be common truth lying around us. And, you know, it's only the smart guys. And because I think Bangladesh, the new generation of youngsters who are now getting educated, they're in a rush, you know, they want to achieve. So if you can harness their spirit of enterprise, then I think we can find newer ways. I think I have largely covered points. So thank you very much for giving me a patient hearing. We'll work together for all this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It was indeed an inspiring speech, and let's all hope for the best to happen. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we have the presentation of memento. We have 9 distinguished recipients of the memento. May I request first the DCCI president to do the round of honors. The first to receive the memento from the DCCI president will be our chief guest. Thank you, sir. Now I request Mr. Tajul Islam, MP, chairperson of the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Power, Energy and Mineral Resources. Next to receive will be Dr. Muhammad Tamim, the keynote presenter. Thank you very much, Mr. President. And now I request our Senior Vice President, Mr. Kabrul Islam, FCA, to present memento to the moderator of the session, Dr. M. Fozul Kabir Khan. He will present another memento to Dr. Salim Mahmood, our panelist. And Dr. Ahsan M. Mansoor, Executive Director, Policy Research Institute. Thank you, sir. And now I request our Vice President, Mr. Hussein A. Shikda, to present memento to our panelist, Dr. Molla M. Amjad Hussain. Thank you, sir. Dr. Mushfiqur Rahman, Technical Director, Rupur Nuclear Power Plant. And finally, Engineer Rizwanul Kabir, Managing Director, ECPV Chittagong Limited. Before I request the Senior Vice President for his closing remarks, I would like to draw your attention that we have another discussion meet after lunch, titled Chittagong Port, Current Status and Way Forward, in the same hall here, and which will be chaired by M. Khalid Iqbal, BSP, NDC, BSC, Chairman, Chittagong Port Authority. That will be after lunch. And now I request our Senior Vice President, Mr. Kamarul Islam, for his closing remarks. Mr. Kamarul Islam.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Honorable Advisor Dr. Taufik E. Elahi Chowdhury, Bir Bikrom. Honorable Member of the Parliament, Mr. Muhammad Tajul Islam, MP, and Chairman on Parliamentary Standing Committee on Energy, Power and Mineral Resources. Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. We have reached the end of this lively and vibrant event titled Energy Security 2030. Challenges and Opportunities. It was a wonderful gathering of such eminent people from different avenues of energy sector, including government agencies, policymakers, industry, energy expert, academia, researchers, and media. The seminar highlighted prospect of rapid GDP growth with extensive job creation in a high-performing and diversified manufacturing sector through energy security. The seminar also emitted some crucial recommendations for ensuring energy security, such as stress on switch from conventional to integrated resource planning and encompasses bottom-up approach, demand-side management, environmental consideration. For affordable, reliable, sustainable, and modern energy for all, focus needs to be given on fuel mix optimization, ensuring economy, environment, and energy security. Frequent policy shift, uncertain fuel mix, and unpredictable future price for electricity and gas are identified as prime bottleneck for energy security. Comprehensive attention needs to be given on extensive onshore and offshore exploration, overseas resources requirements by BAPEX, immediate decision on local coal development. Focus on energy policy diversification encompasses gas, coal, renewable energy, regional energy trading at least 3 decades before. I would like to echo likewise most of the eminent expert speakers who commented and emphasized on long-term energy and power sector projection. Ladies and gentlemen, DCCI would like to bring into the notice of concerned government agencies, especially in the consideration of Honorable Energy Advisor. I would like to extend thanks to ECPV Chittagong Limited and Riverstone Capital Limited to be partnered with DCCI and for commitment to make this event so successful. Ladies and gentlemen, we believe today's event will chart the way forward of energy security, ensuring the cross-section of industrial interest in future. However, before concluding, I would also like to express my thanks and gratitude to distinguished chief guest, special guest, participants, print and electronic media, and esteemed colleagues of DCCI once again for valued contribution and make this event success. Thank you. Allah Hafiz.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, now we go for prayer and lunch break. The lunch is served at the Ikebana Hall in the basement. You are requested to take the stairs, turn to your right, go to the ground floor reception, and you will be guided to the basement.